Workshop to order, January 18th at 7:03 PM. And the first item on the agenda is a public hearing for the Community Development Block Grant Project, Wadley Falls Road Sewer Line Extension Project, which Mr. Dixon will go over with us. But first, before we do anything, I've got a few agenda changes. We will be, Wilfred Hamel is excused tonight, he's home ill. Therefore, the enforcement of ordinances, item number 8, will be canceled tonight and rescheduled to the February workshop. We are going to move item number 6 to item number 5. We're going to switch 5 and 6 around just for the convenience of some of the public that may or may not be here. And number 7, committee list, Councilor Morrison promised to have it for the February workshop. So that one will be deleted also. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 6, and then 5. 7, 8, and 7 and 8 are removed till the February workshop. Okay. Administrator Dixon.
Yes, the purpose of this hearing is Community Development Block Grant Program requires 2 hearings, one prior to the start of the project and the submission of the application, and one during the progression of the project. Tonight, we're having that second and final public hearing, which is required by OSP. The notice in the paper was required to give a 10-day prior notice. That was done in accordance with the RSAs and regulations by the CDBG program. We had it published and posted in 3 places within the municipality. We'll be conducting the hearing tonight. We'll be taking any input that the citizens want to offer. We will provide written answers to complaints and grievances within 15 working days, where practical. If there's grievances that seem to be more involved, it may take longer than 15 days. But generally, we will respond within the 15-day period. So I guess I would open tonight's public hearing on the Wadley Falls project by stating that project to date, the gravity line is in, it is complete. The pump station has completed its first round of testing, which is satisfactory. There's going to be another round of testing because need to have adequate water to take the pumps. We know the pumps work. We need to take the pumps through a complete cycle. That will be done probably in the next week or 10 days. The force main has been tested. It is complete. Vegetation will be on a punch list for completion this spring. We have a hydrant that was taken out this fall for expediency purposes to complete the water connection. That will be relocated and put in place as early as Mother Nature allows us to do in the spring. The road finish will be applied in the May-June period. And I qualify the May-June period because, number one, May to mid-May is generally when the hot top plants ramp up. And it may take us a little while to get it on schedule. So it should be done within that May to June 15th period. Spoke with Phil McDonald here tonight. He'll assist me if there's any areas of follow-up that need to be done from an engineering viewpoint and on the project. But mainly tonight, we are here to take input from the people. The project will be ready for the to accept the sewage disposal from the elderly housing project on Wadley Falls. On schedule. And talking with the developer last week, it appears that they may be looking at some occupancy as early as mid to late March. April is definitely doable, okay? And looking at a ribbon cutting ceremony for grand opening sometime in the probably June period, maybe May. He'd like to have all the groundwork completed, everything manicured before it happens. So with that, if there's any member of the public that would like to speak, have a question answered, anything of concern regarding this project, Yes, ma'am. Could you come up to the, and state your name and address?
Deborah Turcott. I live at 285 Wadley Falls Road, just across the street from this project, and which has been a nightmare right from the start for us neighbors in this whole neighborhood. One of the main problems I've had with the sewer and the water line put in is I have had a disruption in my power lines underneath the ground, which in the process have to now be dug up and changed. I have a temporary wire from the pole to my house, which has been ongoing since they started blasting. I also had a broken water pipe, which flooded my house. I guess we can't really contribute that to the blasting, but the blasting was, you know, jarring enough to shake my whole house each time. And of course, if you lived in my house, you would understand the frustration I've had all spring and summer with this project. I stopped in about 4 weeks ago and left a nice message for Mr. Dixon to call me back. He has not called me back about to address these issues. So I'm a little frustrated and like to know who's going to be responsible to fix my lawn and my wire.
I did, in fact, return a call. The only issue that I knew that you had of concern was the street light. And the street light is something that's required by the planning board.
Who did you call back? Because you did not get a hold of me.
Well, I did call back, and I did leave a message on the line.
You certainly did not. It was not my house or my residence. So, and if there was no, if you didn't get a hold of me, you could have called me back again. I have an answer machine, and there was no message on there from you. So, and I do have the issue with the light. I mean, the light shines right into my room. I mean, there's got to be some kind of issue where you can shade part of that light. I don't know. But even with my shades shut, it's like I have a glow light in my room constantly, all night. So that's a little frustrating.
Ms. Turcott, could you put these in writing for us and submit it to Mr. Dixon, who will call with the town council, just so we can follow up and make sure these things get addressed?
Yeah, I mean, they've staked out my yard. They got to dig up my yard. This, you know, I've started losing power when they did start the blasting. I could not stay in my house on my days off. I'd have to leave the premises because my whole house, it was like a wave was going underneath my house. Literally, you're like each blasting.
Do you know if someone came by and took pictures of your foundation and stuff like that?
I believe they came by, they did a videotape, they walked through the house before inspection, you know, before that and all that. Okay. I have no problem with that. They did everything correctly. You know, and the other thing was we weren't notified at all. None of us neighbors were notified when you guys just stopped, cut the road off, can't go out. Okay, I go to leave for work. No, you can't go out. You got to go around the other way. So I'm late for work. There's no notification to us that, you know what, we're going to have problems with this section of the road. We're going to shut down. Nothing. Nobody was notified. So as you can imagine, there was quite a few frustrated people. And, you know, it's not just me. There's quite, you know, there's people on the road who are just as frustrated. And, you know, I'm dealing with this from day one, 5 o'clock in the morning, they're delivering equipment in the yard. You know, it's just crazy. And even if I wanted to sell my house to get out of the situation, I could not. You know, it's just the potholes, no one ever fixed the roads. You know, there's black patch. They could have put the black patch in instead of having big potholes in the road. But no one, we were out there filling the holes ourselves at the end of the day because the ditches were so deep, and I'm sure some of you have traveled that road during this time, were so deep that if you went 10 miles an hour, it was too fast. You know, and I know Mr. Dixon made a comment about, well, maybe we'll keep the traffic slower. Well, that's pretty ignorant remark because it's dangerous even going 30 miles an hour over those bumps. It just was unacceptable.
Okay, and if you would put this in writing, submit it to Mr. Dixon's office, he'll copy us on that and you'll get a reply and response, and I'll make sure that we follow up on this.
That would be much appreciated. All right. Yep. It's just crazy to have to deal with this all spring and summer, dealing with it.
Thank you very much.
Next.
Is there anyone else? Mrs. Berger?
Yeah. Debbie Berger, 308 Wadley Falls Road.
This is public comment.
Just a question, is this limited only to the effect of the sewer, or is it in relation to the whole project?
It's just the sewer.
Okay, just the sewer. As Debbie just said, the road is a disaster. I don't know why that could not be addressed. It's one of the sloppiest, I mean, they put the sewers in, they patched it. It's, anyone who drives out there can see what a mess it is. And of course, it's going to be like that all winter long. Also, the hookups that they did and the digging they did, where Lucille Behan lives right next to Dory.
Do you know her number?
Lucille?
Yeah.
I'm 308. I don't know. Do you know what Lucille is? Anyway, she's next door to Dory on the other side.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
She's had constant runoff, and her whole front yard has been mud.
From the digging?
Yeah, from the digging. And that goes all the way down towards the Loisel property. I mean, me, I'm on the other end, so it doesn't really affect me. Now, this light business, now, it was the last planning board that approved
the light.
All the lights that are approved for the complex itself are as they were supposed to be, which is 15 feet and shaded. The one that's out in the front is a whole different thing. And it, I don't know whether it's the Department of Transportation who wants that there or what, but it's a telephone pole height with a huge spotlight on it.
Yeah.
So I don't know whose jurisdiction it is to get that fixed, because that's a real aggravation. So I think as representing the people that have had to put up with all this blasting, dirt, dust, light from this project, which in fact was supposed to be, I'll just say this quickly, which was supposed to be buffered, now I cannot keep my shade up in my bathroom because I see right into the apartments over there. So there were a lot of things that were done not quite as they said they were going to be done. There's nothing we can do about that, but in the future, I would like to make sure that if somebody says they're going to do something, that that is what they do. There's no way you can buffer a building that is 30 feet above the surrounding area. So hopefully we will learn from this disaster. Thank you.
Thank you. Anybody else?
If there's no other comment, then we'll close the meeting. Your comments will be taken in hand. They'll be in the minutes of the of this meeting and compiled. Thank you.
Al, do you have anything else on this?
No. No. It's the only requirement.
Okay. Dix? Yep.
Mr. Dixon, who is the engineer on that project?
He's right here with us tonight, Phil McDonald.
Okay, did you subcontract some of this out to somebody to do the digging and all that?
Well, as I'm listening, I'm trying to decipher between the sewer project and the development, which is difficult. But they did, as Al pointed out, the road's been patched. I mean, they didn't have any particularly problems with the blasting other than what you'd normally encounter. I don't know of any delays. Obviously when you're in rock, you got to take it out and remove it, but there was no difficulty in that.
That's not what I'm concerned about. I'm more concerned about who was the contractor, and there's a lack of communication here between the contractor. I don't know if the town did some of the digging or if you had a separate entity.
Well, no, there was a town contractor. It was Parker. Parker and Daughters.
Okay, so.
I don't want to debate this
now.
I'm
not going to debate.
So that's not what we're going to do.
We just need a better means of communication, I think.
Okay, thank you. Councilor Morrison?
Just curious, maybe Phil, you can answer this, or Al. Were they really starting work at 5 and bringing stuff in there?
No, not. There's two separate issues here. One is the housing. Yeah. I dealt with a complaint early on.
Oh, that was from the housing?
That's right.
Oh, okay.
I dealt with a complaint early on dropping off equipment at 5 o'clock, but there's, they're dropping off equipment, and that's something that's allowed. If they were doing it every day, that was not.
Mm-hmm. Okay. One time use. Okay.
It was way more than one time. We had plenty of complaints into the police to come at 5:30, 6 o'clock, 6:15. This was a continuous until Al did call me back on that issue,
He addressed it.
Wait a minute. You just said that Al never returned your call.
That
now you're telling
call.
Me he did?
No, that was the first call we did when the project first started about the equipment delivery. And then
okay.
I stopped in the office about 4 weeks ago and asked for a call back, which I did not receive. I did not receive any kind of call back or on a hands machine.
Okay. Who did you speak with in the office?
Kathy Castle.
Yes, Mrs. Castle.
Okay. Thank you.
And Lauren, I just had another quick.
Go ahead, Brian.
And regarding the like broken water mains and power and stuff like that, is that would that be something the town would or is
well,
that something
I,
the
I'm
contractor?
I'm not aware of any broken water mains.
Oh, theoretically, if there were to be anything like that, is that something the
no,
project?
That would have to be something that would have to be reported to the contractor. We had a inspector on the job, Bob Daigle, who lives in this town,
mm-hmm.
and he was forever present on the job, 8 hours a day.
And Jake Perron, which is
and.
Inspector.
Yeah. We
but
received.
I haven't heard anything about a broken water main. And I haven't heard any of these.
Not so much the specific accusation or claim of a broken water. If something like that happened, would that be something that the construction company would have to take care
Somebody
of?
Somebody would be responsible for it if we knew about it, yes. It
like, would they be indemnified, I think the word is?
Well,
in their contract?
I think, it. You know, we can answer it in general. I don't know what happened. I was never informed of the broken water, nor was Bob Daigle, nor was Phil, who was the project manager, and Bob was
yeah.
the inspector on the job,
yeah.
along with DES.
Who repaired your broken water?
It's not broken water, it's my power line, my underground
oh.
power.
I thought you said something I have specifically.
I had a broken water pipe in the bathroom right after a blast.
Who repaired that for you?
The other owner, I own the house. Gentleman.
Yeah, but who's the plumber you called to fix that?
We didn't call a plumber. He fixed it himself.
Oh,
we
okay.
Had a flood. We had to have an insurance claim. It flooded by.
Who's
I
your...
Was,
do
I
you
was away in California. Came home to a flooded house that had my partner upstairs had to call the insurance company, put in a claim, and, you know, he didn't...
Do you have records of that?
Yes.
Okay. Because we may need those.
Okay.
Okay. I'm just jotting this down. Okay. Brian, anything else?
I think that's it.
Thank you. next item on the agenda is an update on Phase 2 Main Street project. Phil McDonald, Underwood Engineers. Phil?
Before Phil gets started, we had a meeting today with Dr. Porter, who's the division engineer chief over in Durham. The meeting went well. It's always the first step in the protocol is to meet with the Division 6 chief engineer and then go to Concord with at a future date. They always look for the recommendations from the division engineer. The only comments I guess he provided, and he said we could say it tonight, generally he doesn't recommend bump outs, but he doesn't have to maintain them. That was his only. There was one other comment, wasn't there, Phil, relative to it?
Generally, I thought the plans were received
very well.
You know, favorably. And, he doesn't support the. As Al pointed out, they don't support pump outs. They don't. It's mainly for maintenance, I guess. But,
speak up.
I'm sorry. Generally, as Al pointed out, they don't support the bump outs because of the maintenance issues with them. Having that said, they're only through Newmarket. They maintain 24 feet of pavement, and that's all you know. They're going to continue to maintain. That's their. That's we had some discussions about who's the responsibility of the drainage system is. That seems like it's. It would be covered under the funding for this project, but there's some history behind who owns the drainage system in town. And we also talked about an outfall. Presently, the way that we have the 60% design layout for the storm drainage is to tie back into an old pipe on Water Street. So we had some discussion on whether that should be extended to the to the waterfront. And overall, he does, you know, he does have a lot to absorb on the plan, so we left him a set of plans, and hopefully we'll get some feedback on issues as far as the lane widths, the parking, and things like that from him before we proceed with final design and submit plans up to Concord.
Councilor Hart, did you have a question?
Yeah. So DOT does not support bump outs. Is that like the decision, or is that just in general? They don't like them.
It's District 6 doesn't support them. It's, I guess it's not fair to say that DOT doesn't, because.
So what is the alternative to slow down traffic? Do they have any suggestions on that?
His comment was that the amount of traffic flow and just the configuration and the nature of the downtown area will control the speed of the traffic, as it does now.
I think most of the people downtown don't agree with that, that everyone, it does control it right
everyone
now.
That's been hit does.
Yeah. I agree. I mean, that was the biggest concern in all the reports is pedestrian safety, which tells me that people think everybody's driving too fast. So whether or not they're driving within the range of the highway expectation and all that stuff doesn't really matter if people don't feel safe. I mean, if you go down there and clock people, they're going 35. That's not a safe speed for the road in that area. So, I don't know when we get to the point. I'm a little surprised we're getting this feedback now, because we voted on the plans in, like, August of 2004.
Mm-hmm.
I would have thought we would have met with DOT within a few months of that and said, here's what the, you know, 16-foot sidewalks, 24-foot things, all that stuff that we decided in very particular detail.
We had submitted them the earlier concepts. We had, three or four concepts that we submitted to District 6, and we did get some feedback. And there was a letter on file from Mike Burlidge, who was at the time at the District 6 engineer, and he had some things that he didn't like about certain layouts, and I'm not sure if bump outs was one of them.
I know we did that, but I'm saying once the council did that final vote,
right,
and all the very specific details and had consensus on the plan,
right,
it just seems like it's a long time since then to then share it with DOT and get feedback that, I mean, we were asked what's the issues that we're going to fight on, and we made it pretty clear. So I think all those things that came out of that are pretty much things that we want to see happen. There isn't really flexibility. So
before
he didn't
go much further, though. You had to have the 60% design, preliminary designs, to go over with them in detail.
Yeah.
He was offering an opinion of what his flavor. He maintains the roads. So he's offering an opinion from a maintenance point of view only. His decision is not final, and there wasn't an inclination that he would oppose this. It was just an opinion.
Okay.
We are under the understanding that no, as far as maintenance goes, bump outs are not a favorite thing to do. But I have to agree with Councilor Hart that we did talk about pedestrian safety, and that was a big issue. So I just want it clear that is a huge issue for us in the downtown. And
the layout,
if bump outs aren't going to work, I'd like to see a better alternative.
The layout that we're putting forward is the one that the council.
Okay. Councilor Morrison?
I withdraw.
Councilor Jarvis?
I have a couple questions, but is that the drawing right over there? Can we have it up there while we're talking about it? Is it here?
That's it.
I don't know.
It was here the other day.
It's been in here the whole time. I just don't see it tonight.
It hasn't been here for a few weeks, unless it's back there. It used to be over there.
Yeah, it used to sit right here.
Roll
out. I think they'd have that.
August 04.
Let me take that up a little higher. And it's C41.
They're like a C485.
Brian, is that the one we voted on?
I'm not sure if we ever saw it in a final format like that, because we remember we made all these minor tweaks and stuff, but my notes wrote down C41 with a bunch of changes.
These are the last ones that were added in, the pump holes that we're talking about up in here. The intent, I guess that was the intent, keep the traffic coming down off the hills, so try to break the speed here. This one in particular, he was looking at, he said, well, you know, it's an inside corner. It may not for the traffic necessarily, but it's an intersection. It might be a sort of a partial visibility issue with
car parked there.
You know, supposing this car is turning out, and you know, it's a partial block to that. It could be some considerations as far as the spike on that. Overall, he wasn't.
I see.
Overall, the review went well.
Yeah,
that's good.
Just a few comments.
Councilor Glennon?
Are you all done?
I am.
Oh, okay.
This is supposed to be 2 hours.
With the bump out, particularly that one grill that you were showing us there around that corner, are you taking any consideration, or is it premature at this time, to be looking at the area where Riverdale is, if that road were to drop down? Because DOT,
those are one of the,
DOT about
you know,
that at all?
As we get into the design, those are some of the questions that we have. You know, where is that? Is there any?
Do you know
do we have any feel for how, you know, if that road's going down, if it is going down, how far it's going down? Because that's going to impact utilities up in that corridor.
So who's had any contact? I know we've discussed it both at the TIP, at this meeting, at the NCDC. A lot of discussion, but
contact
has,
with whom?
Is we've talked about it here. I'm asking now. Has
from the there's never been formal direction from the council.
Okay, but you had always given the impression that we may be lowering that. So I guess my question is, have we taken any further discussion? I know the council hasn't, but have you taken it to any further discussion with the NCDC and DOT?
No. We discussed briefly that there was some discussion today that might drop in that area because of the whole elevation, but we don't know that. You know, I don't think DOT is particularly concerned if the elevation drops. That's a cost that we have to look at.
But doesn't the phase two go all the way up to the library?
Yes, it does, but I don't know at this point in time. You know, we can spend a lot of money on design. Right now, we know, Phil knows from his work, this is what's out there, and this is the 60% preliminary design based on what he knows will happen right now. Now, if 2 months from now or 3 months from now, property is acquired, it's a green light, hey, now we can, we've got to look at reducing the level there, then he's got to re-engineer that, including the water and the sewer lines there.
Which will be an additional cost.
Well, yes.
But that's engineering.
Yeah, it would be now, it would be right now. It'd be additional cost if we don't do it, if we pay anyway.
I guess I'm confused to where we've all had this idea for quite a while that there's been no discussion at any level other than just discussion, either through DOT or.
Because I think what we had to do was, at least my take on it was, is come up with a 60% plan first, and then. I mean, I think it's recommended that we, I forget by who, that we lower that grade, but we, at least I understood it was going to be an additional cost.
Right.
And we just need
but
to vote
I just,
on it.
I'm just thinking in my mind, where the engineering is now at 60%, how much further are we going to go to the 100% completion before something, I mean, do you need a direction from the council to say?
Well, do you know the fact that we're going to be lowering that?
Do I know for a fact?
Yeah.
No, so I'm asking you.
So I guess at this point in time, what I'm saying is the design is being based on what he know, what we know right now is going to happen. It would be senseless to try to spend money right now to do it, do all that design and projection, and if it doesn't happen, we've spent that money and it's wasted.
I think what Dana wants to know is when are we going to make that decision?
Yeah, thank you, Lorianne. That's my question.
I think there's got to be.
When are we going to do it?
That properties are going to be bought.
Yeah. So we
He's
just
made that decision,
but it isn't done yet, is it?
But
is let me just back up. I mean, this as far as I mean, my history of this. This is kind of initiated with the with some concept for the mills here, didn't it? With the road.
Mm.
What was the driver for lowering the road? It was the mill.
The mill, yeah.
Yeah, it's NCDC, I think, is still quite supportive of the idea in general. There hasn't been a formal decision,
yeah,
but
so
access and
access and
aesthetics.
Visibility.
Yeah.
So
and also there's some safety issues
if,
we've had
you know,
you know, crosswalk.
If I can make a suggestion, if we can get go back to the mill, whoever was driving those concepts, what they had, and get the elevations. I think it was an elevation plan. Did, did they not have an elevation plan?
I believe they did.
Pat Sherman's?
Rough elevation, not tied to an
area. Surveyor.
Was it?
Pat Sherman's report.
Pat Sherman.
Yes, right. It was Pat Sherman.
Okay.
But we never had a cost estimate. We don't, I mean, who would the state cover any costs, or is it all
oh,
town?
Yes. Oh, no.
Yeah, we
And what's the process?
I don't think they get, I guess the steps I would see is getting the section that they would, their preference for the section is, and then we can do a cut and on a profile and make and look at the road and say, okay, how much impact is, how, you know, how far down do you have to go? Where are you going to match back in? And then put a cost to it.
Right. In other words, look at what they have for a concept and then slowly kind of migrate it in.
Right.
And don't do the whole cost analysis.
It's
but
not
there was
in this area because the top of the hill's here, the drainage is really, it's not going to be too much more on drainage,
right.
But it's going to drive the water into the ground,
and
into bedrock. It's going to mean cutting bedrock. I'm still not sure how the access over here is going to work with it, because I don't think they went to that point. They were just, they had their blinders on and they're just looking this way.
Underwood did have at that point in time, that was back in 1999, that if we were to reduce the levels to what they were discussing then during the design charrette, it was going to be in the area of $500,000.
Yeah.
That's as far as it ran.
On these 60% design drawings, we have a profile of that area based on the ledge that was when they put the sewer in. Now, the sewer looks deep enough, so maybe that's not going to be impacted, but you can
Where's
see
the
that
sewer?
This sewer's down here.
Okay.
But you can see the profile of the ledge.
Yeah, right there, yeah.
Right, so
that would be a concern at some point, and that's an real added cost if you have to blast into that. So I'm saying, I guess, let's look at the Pat Sherman's idea through the NCDC and just kind of look and see what the flow is and what, like Phil says, where's the drop-offs, where's the connecting point? So if he's in that area on the concept 60%, I would hate to see us go to the 95% and then finally somebody comes up with the idea, well, we do have to knock down that road. Let's just say where the NCDC parking lot is and drop that grade down. Then we're looking at a delay time. We're looking at more cost. I just say, let's kind of look at it now.
I'm not convinced it's, you know, there's going to be other impacts with that, and whether it's that's
feasible. There probably would be, and we just need to discuss that at a later
time. You have to know what the whole extent
right.
of that package is going to be.
Probably have a discussion with NCDC.
Get a lot of them.
Right?
What?
Would that make sense? The Phil and the NCDC have some type of conversation on Pat's idea? I mean, you don't have to say it's etched in stone, but if the architect and Underwood Engineering have some ideas of what's being proposed. Just makes sense.
Councilor Hart?
Yeah, I mean, yes, I think that's a good idea. I guess what I'm having a hard time grasping, there's two private properties that would be impacted, Riverdale and the Eagles.
Great. Durham Book Exchange has a bridge that goes over that that pedestrian walkway, and if we lower the road, we're going to, there's no way it's not going to mess that up. What's that?
There'll be a high bridge.
Well, no, but I mean, it's really close to the edge of the road. I don't know how we could.
But the question is, I guess what I'm having a hard time, Phil, understanding is, I kind of agree with Councilor Glennon. I don't want to delay making a decision about this because I don't want to delay the actual project from happening any farther than it's been delayed. So when do you need a decision on this? And so you can do the engineering and figure out the analysis so it doesn't delay the start of the actual construction any further.
Well, it's one of the things we wanted to talk about tonight. You know, as we're looking at this, there's some good portions of work that can be pulled out and expedited even in this season. And as you, as we develop the 60% design for the utilities, specifically the water and the drainage, we have them on the east side of the road. And we did have some discussion today about what would we need as far as permitting and coordination with DOT and other parties to put something forth even in this construction season. And literally all we need from DOT was a commitment to the curb location to site the catch basins. Huh. A lot of the other issues with transportation enhancement, the sidewalk, the section, because that's federal money, that triggers the Section 106, the historical and archaeological investigations. The timeline for those is much longer. That getting all the utilities, the underground, the power, and the cable, and all that, because you're dealing with each individual property, those are long, long lead things. Putting the water and the drainage in on the main run from up through there could be broken out, and it might also, because it's more of a straightforward portion of the work, and it would be just confined to one side of the road, that it would provide a learning curve, if you know if that's the correct term, but you know, a lot of, because it's a simpler part of the work, a lot of that could be conducted, you know, you can find all the bumps in the roads, you know, as far as how people are going to get around, the access to the businesses wouldn't, because that's on the other side, would be the least amount of impact to construction. It would also give us a chance to, when we're digging, to find out more information in the ground to try to reduce unknowns for a second a second phase types of system. So those are some of the things we're kicking around, and I don't know if we can do all that tonight, but maybe session.
I think my thought was just to bring the idea forward, to have the starting process to look at that and see if that's something we want to do, so we don't get hit and delay the project and say, now we're going to lower, so we got a commitment from DOT, but now we have to go back and redraw some things.
Well, in reference to the hill, utilities are on this side, and up to a point where we know nothing's going to change, you could draw a line. Mm-hmm. Until, if for some reason, if we couldn't get to a decision on what's going to happen with the hill, mm-hmm. because the sources of funding aren't in place or whatever, property's not acquired.
Right. Would you agree that this would be the time to be looking at it?
Before we finish the design up on that end.
Councilor Morrison.
Oh, can I be skipped for one?
Yeah, Councilor Hart.
I just had a question. I think what I heard you say was that you're throwing around the idea, engineering wise, of doing the main water line replacement and sewer replacement in 2007 in the summer.
Storm drain.
Storm drain?
Storm drain and water, 2006.
Oh, this is the summer, yeah, that's what I meant. Sorry, that's good. I'm still, like, can't believe it's 2006, so. So, that, and then that way, so it would be the water and the drainage system. And then in 2007, we would start doing hopefully utilities and realigning the road, putting in the curbs, connecting the buildings to the water and sewer lines and the drainage system. And then, okay.
This yellow line here, the water and the drainage is on that side of that road.
It's on the Rivermore side?
It's on the Rivermore side. The existing drainage is over here against the curb. There's an old brick box and it connects over through here. So that would all stay in play.
Until 2007.
Put the utilities under this side, do the road blocks out until out to the center where we have the center line drawn. Now that center line is a little bit of a shift in spots through here, east of where the existing one is. So, but there is room for a, because we haven't pinched the road on this side yet, that you still have more room, and room is what we're going to need for doing. So, because this sidewalk hasn't come out yet, we feel like we could probably do this with the least amount of impact to the downtown area. And also, we could, with the coordinator that's going to come on board, and folks, and us, we could learn some things by doing it.
Jerry, can I just follow with this? Mm-hmm. Jerry, you've done this kind of work before and have a lot of experiences, and you were...
Not to this scale.
Right, mm-hmm. But you've reminded us that to do all the connections and the power, the utilities and all the stuff is a lot of different companies doing a lot of different digging, and they all can't happen at once.
What he's talking about, though, he's talking about, well, we go in and we do the water.
Yeah.
Get the water out of the way. And then once that's in the ground, because they got to put the main in, then they got to go back and they got to dig up, tie in all the services. So it's a lot of work. Then they'd, I don't know what the other service was he was talking about at the time, drainage the same year or sewer?
Right.
Drainage
and water, at least through the downtown area. The drainage goes from where we ended off on, the water goes from where we ended on down by New Road all the way through to the Lamprey. But, If we did on this, the water through this area is just on this side. So I'm right now I'm specifically talking about the downtown area, the water on this side. Now down in here, if we wanted to do the full utility build out, we could also add that into this contract. But it would, this area here, if we could bring traffic around, we could probably manage that also. What I'm suggesting is that maybe we should be looking at taking a piece of this and doing it this year.
Wow.
And as far as what those pieces are, we'd sit down and go over that. But,
would you, just to follow up, to clarify, would you connect buildings to the new water line, or would that wait and it would just sit there waiting to be used until... That's something you haven't.
Once again, that's a thing that we need to decide. I mean, if you wanted to connect the buildings up, that starts, now you're starting to cross the street.
Yeah, that's a lot more complicated.
So, yes, that could happen, or it could wait. I mean, it's all entirely, the other things is you can put those items in there in a contract as ad alternates. You're not locked in. You're not happy with the way things are going. You don't like the contractor. You don't do it.
Lost.
Pardon?
I guess I'm lost.
Wait a minute. There's a couple of people before you. Councilor Jarvis?
I have a couple questions, Phil. If you were thinking about doing the water and storm drain this summer, so that would mean that we would dig up the road this summer, patch it up, and then dig it up again in 2007?
We would dig out to that yellow line. We would, first the utilities would go in, the water and the drainage, and some stubs, the drainage that's going to start across the street. And then once that's gone in, then they'd come in and they replace the materials under the pavement, and then you'd pave. So you'd have, I wouldn't say half a road, but you'd have from this line out with new pavement, with, say, base pavement. The finished pavement wouldn't get installed until everything's complete. But you'd have, you'd be done. The idea is, Jen, is you'd be done under that section.
So you wouldn't be digging that section up again?
No.
Everything under that section would be done during that time period. And then the next summer you'd just move to the other side of the road. Okay. And how would this affect your projection of a 19-month construction time for 2007?
It's all a function of what the town and the businesses can digest, I think. You know, it's...
Well, I'll tell you, the 19 months is hard to digest. So if we're talking 19 months...
But the time...
Plus another... Yeah. 6 months. That's what I'm just trying to get.
The work time,
I'm trying to get
I'm
a
not
feel
sure,
for.
You know, if it's, it could be hell if it's compressed into a, you know, it could be much worse.
Right.
You there'd be a lot more cost overruns. There'd be a lot, you know, it's a lot more difficult to work on a projected schedule, managing everything else that has to do. It's got to be manageable, I think.
Okay.
And, we are still committed to looking at some, and we're open, you know, to different phasing of different things. If it's, you know, whatever will work in this thing, and is you know, we're all for that. And we need to talk to, we'll talk to some contractors, and we'll get some ideas. We've spoken to a couple. I spoke to Park Construction about nighttime work, and he's done it. One, it's a lot more expensive. Two, we said that people have, it's good for short periods.
Right.
You can do it 2 weeks, but he says everybody gets batty after a while. It's not a normal operation. You know, you take people that are normally up during the day and you put them at night, and you know, it's, things will happen. You know.
And then my other question is that when you describe the source of funds, I'm having a hard time following where the sidewalk, landscape, and lighting fit into as far as where that funding is coming from, and the extra $10,000 to retain a landscape architect. Where does that fit into the source of funds on the front page?
Landscaping and lighting would generally come out of the TE. Everything beyond, outside the curb line.
Transportation enhancement?
Right.
Okay. And then we've been talking about that this is 60% design, but in reading this, what it's seeming to me is that it's only 60% design of storm drains, 60% design of water, and 60% design of sewer. I haven't heard anybody say that it's only 60% of sidewalk design or parking design. Is that to assume that when alternate C4-1 was accepted by the town in September 2004, that's it for the parking and the sidewalks and the bump outs?
Well, I guess what we're saying is that the drawings that I've submitted, I don't know if everybody's gotten a copy of them, but...
I didn't. Nope.
The drawings.
I have these. I don't have drawings.
Were you a member of the council that time?
No, she was.
No, we recently.
I mean, I've seen this. I'm not, I've seen this.
We got 11 by 17 drawings.
We had, you had a roll too, didn't you?
Yeah, we got one of these. This is the same thing up there, but it's dated August, so I think we made changes.
That's, right, that's just the, that's the layout.
Okay.
Right.
The plans we submitted were for the layout, the 20 scale, well, the design drawings. They had the layout, and then they have the utilities, the storm drains, the sewers, the water. And then there's a set for the underground utilities.
So things as far as people not being able to access their buildings because there's, or access their parking through those, the way that it's designed there, those are things that are going to be addressed later? Like the community church not being able to access their parking, that's something that's going to be addressed at a later?
Well, we understand that the community church doesn't want their, this piece here of sidewalk because it's blocking blocks. They have, they pack six cars in here, I guess, on this side. So this right here isn't on the, this is a long ways from being accepted by Rivermore or the church. We were hoping that we could get, just because we think it's a better, you know, layout for that parking lot, it only provides one curb cut. And we were hoping that they could work together on, as far as, you know, assigning six spaces over here for the church.
So there is still a little massaging and playing around with some of the parking and sidewalks and how it affects people still?
Yes.
From our, I mean, I guess from our point of view, yes,
on the whole
as well
street?
As, no, I'm just saying that what we've talked about is the, I mean, I've just heard some suggestions or some issues about C41 as far as it relates to parking bump outs and sidewalks and how it affects certain businesses. And that's why I wanted to know if, but it sounds like you've answered the question that it is still a work in
it's
progress.
Still considered 60%
of 60% of the design of all design. Okay. I have one more, sorry.
Mm-hmm. That's all right.
If we talk about starting this construction this summer, I just wonder where that puts us as far as whether we're able as a council to meet some of the suggestions and some of the things that we thought were important to get done before construction started, such as on your plan here, the interim parking plan for downtown businesses needs to be developed. I know we're working on the project coordinator position, whether or not we can
she's
get that
hired.
Person up to speed in 2 months, whether that's enough lead time to make sure this goes off with as much communication as possible. I feel a little bit nervous about that, but that's something we can talk about and whether or not we can expedite the things that we wanted to get done as a council before it started. I think that's it. Thanks, Phil.
Councilor Morrison.
It's about the lowering 108. If this final design, it says here the deadline is it the process begins at the end of January 2006 and ends the end of July? Or is that the application? I mean, do we have to have the application in? I mean, how does that work for the final design stage of this project schedule?
You're looking at the project schedule?
Mm-hmm. I'm just thinking if we have to tack on lowering 108, that's a massive, I mean, is that the other 40% of the project? Because it's almost the right size.
I guess what I'm saying is I'm not sure that enough focus. I mean, I understand the discussion and why it started, but I'm not sure that anybody's looked at the implications of.
Well, that's my point exactly. I mean, that's a huge.
That's aspect. Something we need to talk about.
So I guess what I want to know is a time frame for when we need that, because I would really be against having something like that come up at the last minute.
We'll talk about that later on this evening.
I think it's important to know that decision should be, you know, we need to look at that before we start putting a pipe in the ground up this way.
Absolutely.
I mean, if we were to, if that decision was in limbo, you know, I would be, my recommendation would be to stop the utility work at the, you know, at the point of the hill.
Yeah.
That where, you know, where if you put it in, that you, you know, it's no good. You got to take it out and lower it. You know, you don't want to do that, and you don't want to stick it. You don't want to stick it 15 feet in the ground because you don't know how low the road wants to be, or, you know, because, you know, just let's put it real deep so it won't be in the way, type thing. Because then you, you know, you, you're just spending a lot of money.
I guess my, I just sort of, my point overall is I think we should have absolutely everything nailed down before we break ground.
Point taken. Anything else?
Yeah.
Councilor Glennon?
Phil, on one of these bullet points here, under 60% design the sewer improvement, exit a road complete. The next bullet says options of cost update. Options of cost update. Can you give me an idea what that is?
Yeah.
Opinion.
I guess that's a typo. Sorry,
I was reading it as option. Opinions of cost update.
I guess it's a typo because they put that in meaning and intending to do that, but it hasn't been done. So I haven't updated it based on that design.
Oh.
So
okay. I did have another question here. Looking at, I guess it's page one or page two of the work plan status report. I just turn that page. Oops, I just had it here. Okay. On the schedule 4.0, design should be completed by December of 2007 construction season. When you say design, and you're talking about the, in other words, the council approves all of the, I say, bump outs and all of the design and all that. Is that the final design you're talking about?
Yes.
Okay, because right below it, it says targeted bid for early 07, target construction.
Yeah, that
March 07.
That doesn't read very well, Dana. That should say design should be completed by December 2006.
Okay.
Before 2007.
Okay, and then with construction starting in March of 07.
Right.
Thank you. I read that three times. I'm like, how do we do this? Okay, thanks for that point of clarification on that. I did have another question, though. I think probably it was answered by Jen, by her question. So I'm all set for the moment.
Phil, I have a question. Under work not included, you have bidding, construction, administration, and construction observation. What is construction option?
We've finished the final design to the point where it's all been approved by everybody, every department, DES, DOT, TE, you know, all the various people, and they all say it's okay to bid it. And at that point, there'd be, there's a construction administration contract which administers the actual work, which would be the inspection, any inspection that was done. And
that's separate from?
That's not included in this, in this scope. This is a design, design contract.
All right. Councilor Hart?
We kind of just went into questions, and I'm wondering if there were specific things you wanted to share. I mean, we had this summary report from you and have a chance to read it, but I'm sure there are specific things you wanted to
get. Well, I guess I'm real happy that you're going to have a coordinator.
I bet you are.
You are, too. And we've had some meetings with the property owner, so we get that process started, and we're happy with the way that's going, too, because we're getting to meet the people, and we're putting all your information, all their, you know, their little things that when you do this, can you do, you know, their little wish list and their concerns into a spreadsheet, and that's going to be continually be updated through, you know, right through to the end of the, you know, the last final paving. as far as concerns, similar to, you know, some of the people that were had issues with Wadley Falls. I mean, we hope to keep that dialogue. As always, I mean, I'd like to know if there's any issues, you know, going through there. So that process has started. We probably met with, I don't know, maybe half or two-thirds. I'd say maybe more than half of the folks down there. And the first half is easy because they're the, you know, the, you go through the list and you find out half of them are available to meet, or you know where they are, and they come, and they, you know, and they're willing, they're excited about the project. We haven't had any people come in and say, you know, I don't want to see this done or anything like that. We've had good feedback, but, you know, it takes 20% of the effort to meet with the first, you know, 50 people. It's going to take, you know, yeah, 80% of the effort to meet with the last 10%, you know, and to track them down. But we, you know, we're happy to report that there hasn't been any stop blocks right now. We still got a couple transformers, you know, that we got to find the spots for. Initially, when we had the big concepts with the big sidewalks, and I'm not sure if this was a fault of ours or somehow, you know, along the line, public service got the impression that, you know, the town wanted transformers in the middle of sidewalks. And I said, I don't think that's gonna. So we've been, you know, trying to find little corners to put them. You know, I think we got one we want to put over here, and some, you know, in these little tucked away in these little spaces. And as you might guess, you know, the folks from Jay Garden don't want to lose one parking space for a transformer. So, you know, we're trying to work with them. We have to go back and work with, you know, it has to go back to utility, public service. They got to reconfigure their power grid, you know, to see, and then we got to go meet with them and try to find a piece of rock we can cut out the back of the jade so we can have that accessible. But, you know, it's tricky business. And then we've done some work with the Legion, and we think we got that figured out down there, so we got to get in and have a meeting with them. But and, you know, just there should be a line on this, because this work isn't part. This was a picture up in here, but the underground power and everything stops, and this it comes down through an exit. We'll be tying more or less back into what's here. But this isn't intended to be part of this next phase. And I guess there's some, you know, we've been finding out other things. There's some work going on in Tasca where they want to come down with some drainage and things. So we're trying to coordinate some of those issues with. Overall, you know, I think the, you know, if it is the council's wish to look at what can we do this year, to I'd probably put a couple of plans together with take the 60% design drawings and put a couple of scenarios, you know, some numbers together for a portion of the project, keeping in mind, you know, the hill and traffic, but and to see how much, whether two lanes can still be maintained, or I'd like to know whether how the town feels about it, or maybe it's comes, you know, if the flavor is, you know, we're going to accommodate the businesses in every way, shape and form, then, you know, maybe it's got to be you got to get some feedback from the businesses of whether one-way traffic will work through town. That obviously be better for us for construction. But if the flavor is, you know, we want to maintain two-way traffic through at all costs, we'd probably like to know that up front, and also that would have a bigger bearing on the interim parking you know, plan, whether that has to be in place before we can do something this year. In other words, if you say we need to have two-way traffic through town, then when the construction work's going on, then you, there's no question, you need an interim parking plan, because you're going to be putting traffic where the parking is. And, you know, so if the business is saying we want two-way traffic, we don't want to lose any cars, drive-bys, then they got to realize, and then they're not going to have parking in front of this store. It's, you can't just squish everything and make all that work. So whether we can do some utilities without having a lot, whether it's some agreement here to put some daytime, 8 to 5 or whatever, parking over here with these folks, or I don't know. There's not really much room in the downtown area to stick a parking lot for the interim basis, but you know, maybe if, once again, if all these things take time, you're gonna make it run to an agreement with the post office. Supposing you take out their island and say, okay, we'd like to do is put slant parking on your other side for the interim. You know, we'd like to get another 20 spaces here facing out this way. All that takes communication and time, and you know that, you know, was it 5 months, 6 months, 7 months ago, the last time I was here, and probably saying what was done, what's been done. But, you know, these things just take, you know, they're going to take a lot of time, and we can't really, we're not really in a position to negotiate with the post office or do that.
Councilor Morrison?
Hi, Phil. Could you just define a couple of things under work not included? Signalization? What is that?
Oh, lights, traffic lights.
Okay, that's what I thought. And archaeological exploration excavations, is that doesn't mean digging the pipe. That's just if they find a Viking ship.
Well, the section 106, we have to do a preliminary evaluation of what someone might find if they dig through.
Dinosaurs.
Right, right. And you guys don't pay for that.
Cemetery.
So we're carrying money for a report. I think we put the dollars in there. What we're carrying for historian or actual.
Okay.
So they prepare initial report, but if they say there's something that warrants
right
excavations to check or something like that, we're not at that point yet.
Okay. Yeah, I was pretty sure that's what it meant. I just wanted to confirm it. And are these questions that you're bringing us, or these problems, or things that you need an answer on tonight, or is there a, like, in your perfect world, when do these questions get resolved?
Well, I guess we can't continue with the design until we decide on a scope and a scope for the contract for the final design and a budget. So that we'll need a decision on. And I don't think the work in here, because construction administration inspection isn't part of this, I don't think phasing is going to impact this too much. I mean, in other words, we're only going to design it once.
Yeah.
And we'll decide if we need to pull portions of that out. You know, it's just a matter of turning layers on and off on the drawings and things like that. But, you know, it's advisable to do the full design, to have at least the design work, so you know, and we'll know that, you know, some we're giving some thought to the next piece. You know, we'll know what certain pieces that we need to
you know, we're just not going to put a pipe blindly in the ground and knowing, you know, that it needs to be all connected up, you know, so. I don't think we need a decision tonight on, you know, some of these things. I think we should probably discuss the, at some point, think about the, if the town's flavor is to do some of the work this year, that we can see what can be done. We can do that. We can go back to the office and put some scenarios together of different portions of the project that could be done this year.
Thank you.
Phil, on the attachment A, the scope of services, the date on the first page is January 12, 2005, but that should be 2006, right?
That's correct, yep.
And basically, this came up before you tonight because you need to start the discussion. There's going to have to be another contract signed, and this is the scope of that contract and the probable cost of that contract.
So we should probably discuss this at the February workshop.
Yes. Yes. That would be good.
We would have put on his homework.
Too late. How's that timing as far as having the contract in place, say, at the March business shop with council awarding this contract? How does that affect you?
February workshop is the first February.
Well, first of February, yeah.
The workshop is the third Wednesday in February, and the decision would be the March meeting, which is the first Wednesday of March, unless we took it out of order.
You want this signed sooner rather than later, or how do we, you know, I guess that's what we're
trying. Well, I guess, yeah, everything just pushes back the window. If we enter into an agreement in March, and it, that just, it does make it a little more pressing, and it might reduce some of the work that we've done this year. But if we need 60 days for design it, to finish it and get it all, which is still, I mean, we still need the DOT to commit to the curb layout, but that, I think we could press before, we can press that now. We could submit these drawings as we have them to the state, ask them to commit to the curb line, so that's not going to be a thing. But anyways, it's March, April, May.
So when are you looking for a decision?
I think it would be in February. That it would help to, if we're going to do something this year.
Yeah. Essentially, it is, I guess, it's not a lot of discussion. You had some questions tonight that aren't answered on this contract. It's moving the project ahead. They're at the end of their previous contract, and now go forward, it's going to cost more money.
I think the things that we do need to discuss, so we need to discuss later on this evening.
Yeah. I have a question.
Right. Actually, Dana's light's been on for 8 minutes.
That's fine.
Dana.
I guess just a point of clarification. You're saying their contract has run out, let's just say, like, for phase one, and we're going into phase two, and part of that contract's run out?
The 60% design has been completed. That's what we signed, the last contract.
There's presently about $35,000 left in the phase one.
Okay.
But the utilities, the power, the cable, there's still some work left. We're still shifting transformers around, so there's still some work left. And if we get, we're carrying $20,000 out of the $35,000 to pay a bill from public service,
okay,
which is going to be coming. And we've signed a PO for them for up to $10,000. So,
but that contract doesn't cover the cost that's outlined here.
No.
Okay, that was my question, because I wasn't sure whether you were saying we needed to let him know what additional things we want done for the summer, or you're just basically saying the contract is at 60% of what we had signed the last contract, and we're running out of money on that contract. And this is why we need to sign a new contract to do the extension for additional work that's coming up now.
You're moving into a new scope.
Okay, yeah. Moving into a new scope.
It's not that we're running out of money. It's that the phases of the first contract.
See, I'm sorry, because I thought that we were going to have to tell him what portion of this phase we wanted done, but that's something totally different. He's going to come to us and make recommendations if we want something done this summer, what you might tackle. Is that correct?
Right.
Okay. All right. That's good.
Well, I think he's already done that tonight. Based on discussions that I had with Phil today and with DOT, what kind of made sense it was going to be tackled was the water line, the storm drain.
Storm drain.
Because those are the deepest points of excavation. Also, as Phil pointed out, they're all on the Rivermore side. I use Rivermore as a focal point. Everybody can relate to that. So all that work will be done on that side of the road and not have to be dug up again next year, because that's it. That's the extent of the take. The other utilities are on the other side.
Yeah. Now, with the storm drain and everything coming on the side of Rivermore and the other side that has the storm drain now, my understanding is that that's not going to be taken out. Would that be like a sort of backup system?
I don't know what you're getting at. I'll let Phil answer that.
It's that would stay in out. Place.
That would stay in place, but would it be blocked up so there would be no drain?
It would still function the way it is now.
It would still function the way it is, okay. And the question that I thought about that I wanted to ask before was, where are we, and I'm not sure if this is your question or whether it's Al's question, where are we with conversation with the Rivermore people and that association regarding the parking lot and all the questions they had? Are we still talking, or?
You mean the area by the church?
Yeah, the church and Rivermore.
Well, yeah, that's
well, the church has that 6 parking spaces they don't want to lose, so I guess we're pretty clear on that. And they don't want to lose the handicapped parking space in the front of the church. But the Rivermore people, because I guess we wanted to do some reconfiguration design-wise and engineering-wise to do a better arrangement of parking. And I thought there was something else we needed from Rivermore. I just was concerned the way
Phil
we are.
I think Phil indicated that there's a lot of discussion that's got to be conducted with the church and Rivermore.
Right. It's a joint, it's a joint group. I mean, what this means here, you know, after the letter that I heard Al read to me today, is that you can't put this piece of sidewalk in. It also means that if we were to maintain, so they're going to maintain their own lot. We're not going to do anything in here if we can't do this.
Right.
Because that goes where they're straight in parking. So if we can't do that, we're not doing any of the resurfacing or striping here. The only decisions left is whether we
have a single entrance or two entrance.
We got to tell them, look at either.
Okay, so that conversation is pretty
much
done.
Well, I think we touched on that conversation. We had the Reverend here, and we had a member of the board here for the utility meeting, and there was some discussion there. So that it's been ongoing.
Okay.
I did get a letter, an email from Rod Bowles today, whereas he became aware that the design portion of the Main Street renovation project was complete, wouldn't I wish? and that his concern was that the community church has been opposed to the change, but he continues to see it in the design. And I did respond to him and also asked him to give me a phone call. Indicated that all we have is 60% of the preliminary design complete at this point, and that here the community church is on record as being opposed. Rivermore is on record as having a problem, and they're going to have to be talked to. It's going to have to be worked out.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you for that update.
Councilor Hart and then Councilor Jarvis.
So what other contracts should we expect? Because that's a little unclear to me. So we have this contract, which is for up to 95% design.
Or 100%.
Okay. So we'll get the 75% design and 95%.
When we bid it.
All right, and then there's the contracts with the actual companies doing the construction, which I'm assuming would include these things that are not included: the building, bidding, construction, administration, which would be you guys, and or observation, which would be you guys. If we had to do any signalization, that'd be a separate contract with somebody else, maybe one of the same firms, but.
Well, we just didn't carry it.
Right. I just want to.
You know, but there was some talk down at the Jerry.
Yeah. There's going to be their signalization there from the fire station, so.
Well.
I mean, if we're going to update it in a few years to a full system, it's pretty dumb. I mean, if we're going to do it, we should do it now. Well, you know what I mean?
Right.
So if we're going to study later that, we should have that as a full system, you know, with a stoplight, then I don't know why we're not doing it now.
Because we talked with DOT today, and in order to do that down there in Jerry Ave, there's going to have to be some acquisition of additional
right
away.
Because they want a turning lanes.
You can't.
That's obviously a lot more complicated. Yeah. So be it. But at least have stuff. And then, but we wouldn't expect any other contracts with you guys.
What's that?
Any other contracts? Because I thought we had signed a contract that was for all of the engineers.
That's what I thought, too.
Not for the total cost.
So now we have another $150,000 that. It's a little hard to understand if it's in the budget number that we've heard, or if it's on top of that, or if it's just a number that's been in there, but I've never seen it broken out.
There have been projections, including the total cost of the project, including the preliminary engineering, the final design, mm-hmm. the construction,
right.
and the construction.
So this is not a new number. It's a number that's within the range of numbers that we've had.
Yes. Right. And the next contract you'll see after this one is, like you said, your bid documents, your construction, you're in construction
right.
mode. And,
mm-hmm.
and
so that would be with a company that, if we do the work this summer, with them?
Well, it'll also be with,
right,
with Underwood for the inspection services.
Yeah. Well, I'm comfortable with this coming to the February business meeting. I mean, we can discuss it more there. I'd be happy after people have digested it more, gotten feedback, whatever. But I don't want to delay until March. I don't see that. I think that's necessary, personally.
Councilor Jarvis?
That being said, Brian, we can agree to this contract, but then still negotiate on whether or not we want it to start this summer or.
Right.
I mean,
that's,
those are two separate
entirely,
things. Right.
Yeah,
so we can say,
up.
And that's why I'm, that. So we can move on this and say,
right,
we're ready to move forward on this. We agree that you're at 60%. Take it to the 100%,
right.
And in while the time you're working on that, we're going to be doing some discussions on whether or not we want it
right.
to happen this
yeah,
summer.
Yeah, you know, it's been the process has been working the way it's been set up, because by doing the preliminary engineering and the design, it kind of enlightens you to, you know, where the layers are. You know, the there's such a huge duct bank down there for the electrical and cable, the TV, the fire alarms. I think we probably need a fire line for each building, and we realize it's so big that to have the cross pipes, the drainage is going to have to be deeper. The water is going to have to be deeper. So you want to. It seems like you want to put those in first.
Mm-hmm.
So you get the, you know, you get the space. You need to create the space for the underground utilities.
So when we, sorry, were you still on a thought? No, okay. When we do, let's say that we did start construction this summer and do the water and the drainage on that side, that would only put us kind of status quo to what we have right there now for sidewalks and parking. We wouldn't be putting in the new sidewalks or any of that. So then we would be revisiting that side later on after all the underground stuff is done. We would go back to revisit that side to update
that's
sidewalks
right.
and
you
parking.
Know, and
okay, I just want to clarify
be
that.
Doing the box section just from the curb line that you got there
right.
to the yellow line. This, I wouldn't propose putting a sidewalk here as part of the work on this side of the road, because when you do this side, you're going to want every bit of space
right.
to put traffic over here. So, I hate to bring up that subject again, but you know, if you could pitch your traffic as far over this side as you can, you know, they're on where the sidewalk would be. So that'd be a traffic shift, and you'd want to use all that space where we have the sidewalk right up through here.
Right.
So to make it doable on the other side.
Sounds good.
The earlier statement that you'd be done in that, you'd be done with the deep excavation, there would be no more utilities.
Right, and that's what I just wanted to clarify, so that people didn't think that that was going to happen, so that we will, so that those sidewalks will be gone, and that'll be used for storing equipment when we're working on the other side. I just want to make sure that
the other thing, the other one thing in the work plan that we probably need some help with, it's a staging area. You know, we need, there's got to be a section. I mean, that's, you know, if we just tell the contractor, you know, you find your own staging area or something, they're going to carry some huge number.
Well, we're clearing a big parking area now. Folks.
Yeah,
that's about the only location that makes sense. If you're going to, you've got to have it relatively close, or you're going to spend a lot of money
back and forth.
Councilor Morrison?
I'd just like to make a motion that we send this to the February business meeting.
For vote. Is there a second?
I'll second it.
Councilor Glennon seconds. Discussion? Councilor Glennon.
No, I was just going to concur what Councilor Hart was saying. I think we should move this to the February. Am I making that second motion? The question was answered.
Councilor Jarvis?
Can you acknowledge Peter Hanley?
Yeah, Peter, I understand. Did you want to share something tonight that you...
If it's appropriate.
Sure.
Okay. Can I
sure. Okay. Oh, no, I mean, I need you to come up.
Oh,
I'm sorry.
Okay. My name is Peter Hamlin. I represent the Newmarket Business Association, also one of the owners of the Stone Church here in Newmarket. Thank you, Chair Capriole, for giving me a chance to talk. And... The Newmarket Business Association is of course, was very concerned about how phase one went and the effect to the business community. As you probably know, there's no business downtown that is thriving in our community as to this point in the development of Newmarket. So we went on a lengthy course of action to look at some of the key economic factors in Newmarket in the future and what's going to happen, those being downtown revitalization, parking, the waterfront and our natural environment, mill redevelopment, and our overall economic development, our marketing of Newmarket as a destination. We are planning on having a February 16th meeting to bring this full endorsement to other stakeholders in the community and hopefully getting more support for our vision and for our goals. The NCDC has agreed to join us in that meeting. They have not endorsed our plan, but would like to use that opportunity to tell the community what they're doing with the mills. Tonight, I'd like to come here and just let you know where we're working on. First, with what's going to happen, Jen mentioned it, 19 months of construction time in a business community that's already hanging on by a thread. A lot of these businesses are struggling downtown. We hear it when we talk to them, are very concerned, are already planning on making sales of their businesses to move out of town, and so we would like to, you know, Tina, the vice president of the Newmarket, we're just talking, and we'll stress our point again, is nighttime work or anything we can do to shorten that time down, we're in favor of, and that we will help and assist in that process to make sure that, you know, that we do. That being said, if we're going to rip up our downtown and the businesses and the people in Newmarket are going to take on the brunt of that in hopes that a better day will be when it's done, we think that we only have one shot at doing this revitalization. We only have one chance to put our town back together the way that we want to. So we went back and got the reports. We got the Newmarket Tomorrow report, the master plan, the Riverwalk plan, other plans at the community parking reports, and we went through them, and we brought this to the full Newmarket Business Association, which is now over 100 members, and I just wanted to read through some of our goals and what we see happening after we put the town back together, after Phil digs it up. From the master plan states a downtown that supports a mixture of uses enabling residents and visitors to shop, visit, and entertain themselves, and improved appearance for the downtown that maintains its traditional New England mill character and pedestrian focus. We talked about pedestrian safety. But what we want to stress is pedestrian focus, allowing people to walk on our sidewalks, allowing storefronts to have their businesses spill out onto the streets so that we truly are a center of commerce. You also on the master plan says maintain the friendly small town atmosphere with a strong sense of community, recreation, and residential businesses use within the downtown. So saying drawing people into our downtown, drawing them onto our bump outs, onto our sidewalks, onto viewing our arts and to our community. The Newmarket Tomorrow report states sidewalks need to be wide enough to safe and allow residents to meet and talk. Sidewalks on both sides. Relocate the bandstand to the proposed lot at the location of the old town hall. Encourage developers and property owners to preserve and create green spaces in the front of their stores and in the vicinity. Create bump outs, curves, narrowing streets, and improve pedestrian and bike safety. We at the Newmarket Business Association came up with these goals for the downtown. Creating an inviting, pedestrian-friendly downtown. Slow traffic down without decreasing traffic flow. Create a living room of our community. Again, creating a place where people want to come. They want to spend their money. They want to shop. They want to dine on our streets. Create a downtown that will draw visitors. So people say, I want to go to Newmarket on a Saturday afternoon. If you go down to Newmarket on a Saturday afternoon in July, there's dust bowls rolling down there. There's no one around. Why? Where are they? And that we feel as though with a revitalized downtown, people will come back into Newmarket. They'll come back and spend their money, and the businesses will thrive. And one of those major points, and I know this is, we don't want to be Johnny Lately on the scene or come late to you and when you've done so much work on this, but we do believe that relocating the community bandstand and the War Memorial to a better place where it can be utilized for community events and community functions, and the veterans can utilize that bandstand as a place to have events and have their celebrations at the same time meeting our goals of having a downtown that has wide sidewalks on both sides that we can use and utilize and present to the rest of the seacoast and create an economy that attracts visitors to our community. So again, we know that you're still in a lengthy process. We know that you have a lot of work to be done. And we just want to come to you today and say that we believe we still only have one chance to do this. And we believe that we should do it right. And we should believe that we should stay true to what the Newmarket Tomorrow Report says, to what the master plan says, and what our members of the Newmarket Business Association say. So we would recommend that you please look at this plan again. And think about bump outs in a different way, and think about this bandstand in a different place being utilized on weekends, and think about what that can do for our local businesses, because we're the ones that are going to suffer for 19 months. We want to make sure that after 19 months that we're going to benefit from this revitalization.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay. No, I'm sorry.
From our community member, that's
well, he called me in advance and asked, so, and I knew he was going to be here tonight to speak. We have a motion on the table that we need to vote on.
Can we say it again, the motion?
Move the contract to the February business meeting.
Okay.
Right, Mr. Secretary?
Right. We'll have a resolution prepared. Okay. Councilor Hart?
Aye.
Councilor Morrison?
Aye.
Councilor Jerry Hamill?
Aye.
Councilor Glennon?
Aye.
Councilor Jarvis?
Aye.
Councilor Capriola?
Aye.
Motion carried.
Can I ask a question?
Mm-hmm.
I guess I didn't know if you wanted to speak, you had to call in advance.
Well, this is a workshop, and he had some concerns regarding the business and how the 60% phase is going to work, so I granted him permission when he called in advance. It's not a public hearing, it's a workshop, and it's up to my discretion. And I don't want to get in a big long debate about this whole thing. There'll be plenty of other public hearings.
No, you just answered the question. I was concerned to whether they had to call in advance.
If Renan had something that he was representing a group or community that had something to do with this, then, and he wanted to call me in advance, I would have been happy to have him speak.
So you do have to call in advance.
Continued discussions on water standpipe locations on Durham side of town, George Laney.
I distributed a memo last week. I think you all should have had it. It has several things.
things in it, and one of them is an alternative one and alternative two for standpipe locations. And after reviewing the doing the location on Durham side, I don't believe that's the way to go. I think that we should be looking at putting an additional tank next to the tank up on Great Hill. And
do we own that property?
We own like a quarter of an acre, a very small portion.
Do we own enough for another tank?
I gave you a copy of the site plan. It does have, it looks like there is land, but it has a lot, so I don't think and right now, with the memo I gave you tonight that shows costs and design for an 800,000-gallon tank. Memo from Underwood. I asked them to do me a quick letter memo and do some modeling for the water system. And if you look at the first page of the cover letter has the tasks, and I asked them to look at increasing storage. And the 800,000-gallon tank is based on a letter that came out back in 2002. And we need to look at that further because of population growth and ISO regulations and all that.
You're thinking combined we need about 2 million?
We may need more. In 1987, a report was done on the water system that recommended 2 million gallons a day, 2 million gallon storage. But we don't really know if we need that now. We need to look at that again. And then the other thing is on Durham side, any standpipe or tank we put on Durham side is going to require a pump station, which would include two pumps to pump normal service and then a fire pump for fires. And the thing with that is it's another maintenance item that we would have to live with forever. With a storage tank on Durham side, that water would have to be pumped out on a regular basis, probably at night, so that the water turns over and it doesn't become stagnant, because the water won't come out at that elevation. The existing tank's at an elevation of 199 feet, and then the tank's 60 feet tall. So we looked at four sites on North Main Street that were at elevation 40 or 50. So if you built a tank there, you can't get up to the same elevation, so you require pumping. So looking at, I guess the best thing to look at is the fire flows on the third page. The existing conditions today at the 108 bridge is about 770 gallons a day based on the 2001 model that we did for the town. If we put a new tank up on the hill, option one, Great Hill tank, if we put the new tank on the hill and a new pipe going from where we left off with a 16-inch at right around the Irving and run that all the way up to the tank, that's going to give us about 4,500 gallons a minute at the bridge. If we just put a new tank on the hill and tie it into the other one, the new 108 line that we have today and phase two of this project would give us about 2,600 gallons. So it's important to tie in that line from the Irving up to the tank, which is about 1,700 feet, replacing 10-inch with 16. But still, that doesn't solve our fire flows on Durham side, and none of the options would, because most of the Durham side system is 6-inch pipe. So no matter how much water we have available right at the bridge, it reduces down to a short portion of 10-inch. And then everything is 6. So we need to maybe look at doing option one and then phasing in replacing lines on Durham side, or even just moving forward and continuing from the bridge on Durham side with a project. Those lines may be 10 or 12 inch would be adequate once we have the 16 inch in to the bridge. So I guess my recommendation to move forward with a project, if we want, would be to sign into an agreement to have the engineer look at the actual needs that we, do we need a 800,000 gallon tank or do we need a 1.2 million gallon tank? And then to move forward with there with looking at the materials, there are several tanks. Right now we have a steel tank, which I think would be adequate for another tank. But there are concrete tanks and glass lined tanks. The price of steel today, concrete tanks are more competitive than they used to be. And I guess they're more maintenance friendly. But having two tanks side by side up on the hill would give you valving so that we could take any tank out of service for painting anytime. I just think it's the way to go. I don't think we'd really want to get tied into a pump system over there on Durham side. So the things that we need to look at further, determine the size. I'm on page 4 of the Underwood memo. Determine what we want to construct the tank out of and what the cost would be. And see if we can use the existing land, if we can squeeze it in, or if we have to acquire a little more. And then come up with some cost options.
Al, we voted on this on the ballot, what, in 2003?
2003, we had a...
For an 800,000 gallon tank. Now, we have funds set aside for that, from that vote?
We have bonding authority.
Bonding authority, okay, that's right. Okay. Councilor Hart?
What about the town property near, on Granite Street? Where the fire station used to broadcast off of?
Oh, right over.
Yeah, it's pretty high. It's behind here.
I don't know what the elevation is, but.
I don't think the size would be anywhere near what you would need.
Well, it's got to be a quarter acre at least, so.
You mean where we, on Zion Hill, where we had the tower? I don't think it is.
We own a whole lot there. We were looking at that for parking.
Well,
I don't know what that elevation is, but.
Very minimal parking.
To make it work properly, you need to be at the same elevation that the other one or close, and that's 199 feet of elevation, and then the tank is 60 feet above that. So you'd have to be in that range. They did look just briefly as an idea. They looked down on Bay Road. There is a hill down there. What's it called?
Yeah, I think that's protected land.
Jeff's Hill.
I think it's Nature Conservancy land.
Well, if we were to put a tank out there, it would have to be an elevated tank 140 feet tall.
That's
so,
not going to happen.
Plus, it's several miles out of town.
Mm. How do you happen to know how tall a tank is in Epping by Walmart?
No, I don't.
That's one of those.
Yep. Elevated tanks are way more expensive than regular tanks because of the strength they need to hold up the water, you know, hold up the tank. When it's full.
Yep.
Well, there is a cost.
They got a real bargain price in that.
That was a used tank they bought from someplace.
Yeah, but it was a used tank, too.
Yeah. Was it?
Yeah, wasn't that correct, George? It was
a used tank.
Like relocated.
Yep.
It's kind of nice.
Mm. How'd they get that?
Yeah.
I think Walmart helped just to relocate it and bought it, but it was a used one.
Yeah, it was a used one.
Yeah, it was a used one.
Councilor Glennon?
George, if we go with the option up on Great Hill, which is currently, there is one there now, I guess I'm a little confused because you're not sure if there's enough land up there to put one. I guess my question would be, why haven't you come to us prior to this knowing to whether it is enough land?
Well, if you look at the schematic, you look at the site plan I gave you back in the 13 January, there's a site plan that shows a piece of land.
January, yeah.
Well, it looks like there's a larger piece there. See where I say possible location, but steep drop?
Mm-hmm.
You have to have a good base to put a tank on it because of the weight of the water.
Understood.
And you would have to fill that in, and you'd have to get 100% compaction. And I don't know if it would... Size-wise, it's adequate, but I don't know if it's adequate to hold the tank.
Okay, so the size is okay, but the packing of material to hold it and see if it would hold
right.
That in place. Okay, that makes...
That's something we have to look at.
Okay, that kind of makes sense. Yeah. Now, my other question is, and it's probably for Al, if the voters approve the 880,000, what was it?
800,000.
800,000 tank, and there's X number of dollars on the bonding that goes with that. If we go with a larger tank, do we need to put that back up with the voters to vote on, because the cost is going to go up?
Well, we'll have to have the funding covered, yes. The answer to your question, if we need additional funds, we have to have some.
Any idea where we would get those? Do we have something in reserve somewhere?
We have so many needs and desires with the reserves and the fund balances we have right now,
mm-hmm.
And so many things out there in the floating in the air, that it would take additional probably bonding authority. I've become concerned about the cost, because Exeter's cost is astronomical versus what we had prepared a few years ago when we looked at that warrant.
Exeter is also looking at an elevated tank, which is way more money. On page, the last page of the information I gave you tonight has some cost breakdowns. And option one, it's about $1.3 million doing the 800,000-gallon tank on town land with 1,700 feet of water main upgrade.
Okay.
And those costs, who knows, with the cost of steel and building materials today.
Okay. But again, it goes back to, where are we going to get the additional money? Al, I think you answered it by saying we will probably have to go back out for bonding, which means the voters would have to improve to increase the monies for that bond. Okay.
Well, a couple of scenarios. I mean, if it's not like $1 million, we might be able to address it.
Internally of what we have?
Yes.
Okay. Okay. So that's still preliminary in the works. We don't have anything concrete yet. And that's based because we don't know what type of tank and all that stuff.
Right. I guess what I was looking for is if the council is in agreement that the best way to go would be putting an additional tank on top of the Great Hill next to the other, then I'd like to move forward with looking at that closer to see if 800,000 gallons is adequate or if we have to have more, and look at the modeling a little closer.
Can I make a motion?
Let me address Councilor Hart first, and then, sure.
The other question was, would it make sense to have one 1.5-gallon tank at Great Hill? Because
the best thing with two tanks is you
could build it higher and have more pressure then.
Well, yeah, you could.
And
or we can live with our existing. We can live with our existing pressure and have two tanks that we can valve and use for maintenance. If you were to build a whole brand new tank, you wouldn't want to get rid of this one, because it's in good conditions. But then if you build a tank up here and you've got a tank down here, then this tank down here is only going to use whatever the difference in the water is. The only other thing I did think of, if you could acquire land way on the top of the hill, you might get rid of the booster station over on Falls Brook. I don't know if it's high enough, but that would be a large expense to do that.
Follis Brook or Terrace?
I mean, Folsom Drive.
Okay.
You never get it high enough for that. That static is about 16 pounds is what static is there.
Well, I guess I'm recommending the option where we put another tank up there if we can, because I don't think we want to be tied into a pump station on Durham side that can only feed the system at night, and it has to feed the system at night so that we can empty the tank, because otherwise it'll stay full all the time because of the pressure difference, mm-hmm. and then have a fire pump there that would come on during a fire. And that's going to be something that would have to be maintained and lived with forever.
Just one last question.
Yeah.
If we did the second tank at Gray Hill, which seems to make sense because of the height stuff, without increasing the water line on the Durham side, which is currently 6 inches
mm-hmm.
to 10 or 12 inches, we wouldn't really increase the fire flow on Durham side.
No.
Does the option one in the probable cost have any money for increasing the water line?
No, it has not money to increase it from around the Irving station up to the tank. Because if you look,
I saw the,
that's yes. all we have there.
Okay. And what's the general, is the cost around $140 a foot to do a 12-inch, 10-inch water line? That's what it is on here. Is that what
he had it here somewhere? But
yeah,
is that what he says?
140 a foot.
Yep.
Do you have any sense of? I'm just wondering what the cost would be if we, when we upgrade the Durham water line, what that would be.
I haven't had a chance to look into that yet, but that could be part of this next phase to look at that.
I think it's good. I don't want to be I don't want you to feel like we're surprised when you come back and say, okay, we did this, now we need to spend $500,000 to do the water.
That's going to be the third phase, or you can do it all together or have that as another phase, but we may be able to get away with 12-inch water line over there if we have the 16-inch right up to Bay Road.
Yeah.
We may be able to run a 12-inch or a 10-inch around there. And then their other option was to look at a possible loop going behind these mills and across the river to the Bay Road with another line for a loop to continue that around. That could be a future project that we would
like. Is that for the second crossing?
Yeah, that might be something we want to put in a CIP program or something.
What about going the pedestrian bridge that the NCDC currently owns that the town, we want the town to own? I have no idea structurally if it can handle or if it could be bolstered to handle a water line being attached to it.
I don't even know if we can get to it. I don't know if we could get to it.
It wasn't designed for that. The old one did. The old one had 2 10-inch lines hung across it. This new one is a walking bridge. It does not have the strength to hang up.
Putting a line across the bridge, you could use plastic and you could sink it down with some concrete collars into the muck, and then it just kind of goes in and disappears.
Yeah. All right. Thank you.
Danny, you were going to make a motion?
Yes, I'd like to make a motion that we authorize Town Administrator and George Laney to proceed with evaluating the location of Gray Hill.
Gray Hill Tank.
Gray Hill Tank, second to the current tank that's already up there, do a feasibility. Is that what you're looking for?
Yeah, to look at the size. We're looking at all the
contract amount on that, George?
I don't have a contract amount. I've got to get that. But
probably, if I could suggest that maybe a motion is not necessary tonight, but what we could do is just informally authorize George to gather the data so that we could prepare a resolution. Since you've discussed it, and if we can prepare the resolution, we'll bring it to you to the February business meeting, if that's acceptable.
That is acceptable. Put a cost analysis on it.
Well, with the cost, yes.
Okay.
Of the study.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
So you were drawing your motion?
Yes, I will withdraw that motion.
So a cost analysis of the study.
Yeah. Well, we say cost analysis. We're going to have you a contract.
To approve Underwood to actually do a cost analysis for somebody.
Yes, that's right.
We're going to look at the information on page 4 based upon the above the
cost.
What they recommend we look at.
Okay.
And
so
do the study.
And what I would like to see in those costs, what it's going to actually cost to upgrade some of these lines to the 16 or to the 12. Like, I'd like to see some kind of figure in there, knowing that it's not going to be part of the initial cost.
The lines,
but I would like to see kind of phase one, we get the new tank up there. Phase two down the road, we're going to be looking at this much money for updating these water mains to 16
I could have phase.
Just
phase one would be the water line extension from Irving to the tank with a new tank. Mm-hmm. Then we would have phase two would be upgrading the lines on
Durham side.
Which is going to be $1 per foot, and we'll just calculate it.
Okay.
And then the other line, we would have a cost in there for a river crossing around Bay Road.
Super.
It's those three.
Thank you. Okay. Thank you, George. I'm going to say a 5-minute break before we go on to number 4.
Water and machine up there.
I do.
Right now.
I knew the Main Street would take a while, but I forgot it was on the agenda. And then when I got off the phone with you, I got home and I looked at the agenda. I was like, oh, Ellen's going to get butchered. We haven't pulled this in a while. Hello, Mr. Gatchel. How are you doing? Very good. This is a long meeting. We haven't had a long meeting in a while. I know, that's what Rich said. Oh. I don't think the next item will take up. I read it again because we just got the final and it had the changes. I didn't look at that because, I mean, I'd have to see, that would require more concentration than that. Compared to good right now.
Green Bay, what the hell do you want to win?
Yeah, I think it was. Plus, that was in class. That's good. Oh, okay. $10,000 a day, which is, I think we estimated five or even Spanish. We estimated the cost being.
Yeah, well, I'll trade seats, but it is so hot over there.
I may help you re-explain it, Phil.
Sure.
Thanks, Phil.
Next thing's like 5 minutes.
Standing committees?
Like what? You heard my report from Peter Hamlin because he stole my thunder about the February 16th.
Even if each person takes 5 minutes, that's 30.
I don't have anything.
It's to give us the opportunity. It's not to require us to speak.
Nothing. Huh. We just met and want to go over through procedural things and. Right?
Highway Public Safety, I think, met in June or so. That was last meeting. Will Hamill's not here.
Is there anything in particular that we need to say?
Ellen, are you here for Nordstrom?
No.
Oh. Why are you here?
So the next one down. I don't know why they, those are two different things.
Oh, OK. Okay, yeah, they are. You may be going next because you don't know what play you're going to set.
But if Blair's not here, then we should accept his
We should do what?
Do we have to sign something?
No. It's just that she wanted them to come back.
It's still negotiations.
It's still negotiations, but we'll be by the end of the month.
What's a holdup?
Reconciling
we'll
the farmland
Saturday
money with the Fish and Wildlife
if he wants
Service.
To pop in and give us
no, it's not us holding it up.
We'll be here Saturday till 1 if he wants to come in and give us a
Anybody want one? A homemade.
Nothing's changed.
No, nothing's changed.
How's it going, Terry?
I don't see a concern.
The homemade.
You're holding the easement?
I can't even believe you're eating.
Oh, yeah, well, that's pretty
good. I don't want to catch anything from this bottle.
All right. Where's Jen?
Dun, 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 dun.
Oh, my God.
Okay, I'm going to bring the meeting back to order. The next item on the agenda is number 4, discussion update on the Nostrum easement by Clay Mitchell, town planner, who is not here because he is home with a sick child. But as I understand it, there is really not any new news. Is that correct?
That's correct. I don't have any concerns or issues. I reviewed it.
They're still
Clay.
Negotiating, There's but...
And I don't see any significant changes in the language. But basically, what they're negotiating around is the funding sources. More
okay.
Than at this point.
All right. And the next item was a Silverman Schneer easement, and I believe Ellen is here for us tonight.
Well, this one is hopefully finishing up this week and next week. We just need you to approve the. There's two easements because there's Cecil Schneer, the father, and Jean Silverman, the daughter, and they both own parcels. So we've got the two final easements, and we're going to close next week. So we just need you guys to sign off.
Did those two easements change the P&S price at all?
No.
So they're still the same?
Yeah, and the new that we had to do it, actually the Nature Conservancy paid for the final appraisal sometime last year. And it was higher, so
okay.
So it's still a bargain sale, and even a better bargain sale at this point.
Okay. All right, so you need us to vote on the easements. So does someone want to make a motion regarding the Silverman Schneer? Did I say it right? Schneer?
Right.
Schneer easement. I have a hard time with that.
Just to be sort of clear, there's two easements, one for each. So just say easements.
Easements.
Can we do one motion?
Yes, one motion.
Councilor Hart?
I'll make a motion, but before I do that, I was the one who said, I think these need to come back, so thank you for doing that. And the, easements were shared with me in advance, last week or something, and I did provide some feedback about some particular language that I thought would be difficult to enforce, because we're the enforcers, so, Ellen and Al worked with, the Nature Conservancy, who's the lead agent for the Great Bay Partnership, and it appears that that has been resolved, and I'm comfortable with where it's at in that particular area, which had to deal with motorized vehicles and how you talk about not allowing them on the property. So I think it's a good easement, and I'm happy that it's close to resolution, so I'm happy to make a motion to authorize the who signs this one?
Town administrator.
To execute the Schneer and the Silverman conservation easements.
Second that.
Thank you.
Make a comment?
Yep.
For the viewers at home that saw Tito give one of the counselors money, they just dropped it. So, you know, well, they all, you know, came out of the frame, so. That's all I can say.
All right. Is there any further discussion? Administrator Dixon, can you call the roll?
Councilor Hart?
Aye.
Councilor Morrison?
Aye.
Councilor Jerry Hamill?
Aye.
Councilor Glennon?
Aye.
Councilor Jarvis?
Aye.
Councilor Caprio?
Aye.
Carry. Do you want to act on the Nordstrom or
I guess I
What do we need to act on?
The easement. Authorize the execution of the easement.
I don't have a problem with that, as long as, you know, nothing significant has changed.
Nothing, at this
They're
point
still bargaining themselves amongst
it's
themselves.
The funding sources.
Right,
yeah.
But it has nothing to do with us.
There's a, my understanding is there's differences between how Fish and Wildlife Service and the farmland folks want some of the restrictions to read. I don't think they're of consequence to the town because we support farming and, of course, wildlife's great too. They need to figure out how they can both satisfy their funding requirements and make it consistent with their programmatic. And so it's the attorneys are hashing out relatively minor changes in language.
Okay. So does someone want to make a motion to accept or have the town do you sign off on this one too, Al? The town administrator sign off on the Nostrum easement.
So moved.
Second.
Councilor Morrison motioned. Councilor Jarvis second. Any discussion?
Yes.
Yep.
Who's going to be the protector of that property? Is that going to be?
It's us.
You are. Okay. Thank you.
Administrator Dixon, can you call the roll, please?
Councilor Hart.
Aye.
Councilor Morrison.
Aye.
Councilor Jerry Hamill.
Aye.
Councilor Lennon.
Aye.
Councilor Jarvis.
Aye.
Councilor Capriola.
Aye. Okay, next item is, remember I moved number 6 in place of number 5. So that means the next item would be town council to consider nominations, appointments, and elections of the cemetery trust committee. Just going to go through the process. Everybody gets a everybody that's applied gets nominated. Then we each get 2 votes in the first round. If there's a tie, then you only get 1 vote the second time around. Is that, did I state that correctly?
It's the floor is open for nominations, and if we only nominate 1 person, that's all it.
Oh,
yeah,
okay.
You don't have to nominate everybody.
And you get to vote on each nomination. If there's a tie number of votes, like 6-0 for 2 people,
yep.
Then the council has to revote and only gets to choose 1 person they can vote yes on.
Okay.
Okay, yeah.
So
all right.
That's the process that
Thank you.
We've had for about 5 years now.
Are you looking for another?
Is there any, Councilor Lennon?
Okay, I'd like to put in a nomination for Getchells to serve as, would you have a 2-year term or is it a 1-year term?
6 months.
Just
until
May.
Until May, okay. To fill the vacancy of Councilor Hamill until May.
I'll second that.
I don't think, are we seconding? Do we second?
We don't need to.
No.
Okay.
It's one of those funny things about the process that was established.
Is that what your light was on for, Councilor Morrison?
It was.
Okay.
It's exactly what it was.
Councilor thinking. Jerry Hamill?
I'll nominate Larry Pickering.
That's okay.
Okay. Is there any other nominations? At this time? None? Oh, sorry, Councilor Jarvis.
I'll nominate Walter, what is his last name? I can't read it.
Nidodger?
Nidegger?
Are you here? Mm-hmm. Okay. So, I'll nominate Walter Nidegger, which is what it looks like.
Okay, so all 3 applicants have been nominated, and can we vote on each nomination individually? Is that correct?
I'll move the nominations closed.
All right, I'll move the nominations closed.
Okay. Now you vote.
Okay, individually, correct? All right.
Yes.
You want to call the roll on Forbes Getchell?
Councilor Hart.
Aye.
Councilor Morrison.
Aye.
Councilor Jerry Hamill.
Nay.
Councilor Lennon.
Aye.
Councilor Jarvis.
Aye.
Councilor Capriola.
I can vote on all 3, right?
Yep.
At this point?
Yep.
Okay. Aye.
Well, there won't be a need to vote on all 3 again if you, whoever gets the majority of this is going to get it.
Right.
Okay.
So if somebody gets a clear majority.
All right, then I'm saying nay. I'm changing my vote because I misunderstood.
So the vote was.
I'm understanding this is to affirm the nominations. This is really to vote whether or not you want him in the seat, correct?
Yeah.
Okay.
Right.
All right.
It's 4-2 for That's the one.
Because there's one seat available.
Okay. Next one is Larry Pickering, was it?
Yep.
Yes.
Councilor Hart.
Aye.
Councilor Morrison.
Nay.
Councilor Jerry Hamill.
Aye.
Councilor Councilor Glennon.
Nay.
Councilor Jarvis.
Nay.
Councilor Caprioli.
Aye.
And that was
3-3.
3-3.
3-3. Okay. Now, next one was who?
Walter
Nidinger.
Nidinger.
Okay. Councilor Hart.
No.
Councilor Morrison.
Nay.
Councilor Jerry Hamill.
Aye.
Councilor Glennon.
Nay.
Councilor Jarvis.
Aye.
Councilor Caprioli.
Aye.
It's 3-3.
3-3 again?
I think.
Okay, mm-hmm. You got a clear majority in court schedule 4-2.
Okay.
No further voting.
Mr. Getchell's here this evening, so congratulations.
Thank you for your patience.
Yes.
I admire that picture of you on the inside of your wife's book. You haven't aged a day.
Well, I've heard I've aged a few in my legs. But thank you very much.
Thank you for volunteering.
Okay, next item, Town Council to consider reports from Council Rep committees. Budget Committee, Councilor Morrison.
We haven't actually met yet. We'll be meeting next month after the budget's all done.
Very good. Conservation Commission, Councilor Wilford Hamill is excused tonight. Downtown TIF, Councilor Glennon.
Very brief. We met and we actually were discussing.
Excuse me, gentlemen.
Business.
Gentlemen.
Right.
Gentlemen. Oh, thank you. Go ahead, Councilor Glennon.
We met briefly the other evening, and basically what we discussed was a procedural process that we would use for like electing a chairman and, you know, things like what organizational type thing, because it was never really done before. We talked a little bit about the Kwanzaa Hut, what was going on in that area, and basically that's all we talked about. So there's really nothing we voted on or anything to recommend to council. But at the same time, can I also give you an update? What I don't see here is the ZBA.
Oh yeah, I forgot. Well, that's because you're new on that.
Yeah.
Well, but the ZBA isn't a standing committee.
Yeah, that's right.
Okay, it isn't. Okay.
No, we get the minutes, so we.
Oh, good. Okay.
Highway Public Safety, Councilor Jerry Hamill.
I have a question for the TIF.
Oh, sure.
Sorry.
I'm sorry.
I'm not taking questions.
I'm just wondering, is it possible if we can just get a quick written summary about some of, I think that there's been a few pretty hot topic discussions on the TIF. I think it would be helpful for us, especially when we're talking about what's up and coming in the phase two and what TIF is talking about as far as that. If we could just get some notes jotted down or the minutes forwarded to us or something, yeah. So we can kind of have a, I think it's helpful.
I think we can do
when
the
we're
minutes
talking
forward
about
to them.
A lot of,
Al?
Or if, yeah. You could, if, well, you could just jot down a couple things.
Healy does the minutes.
Right, yeah. Right. And what I can do is request, I have the minutes prior to our meeting here so that I can, you know, give them to you. However, anything else that we discuss usually comes in the form of a motion to recommend to council, and that's something you would receive from the administrator.
Again, I don't know about hot issues. I don't know if there's any hot issues.
No, I think when you were there, we had some hot,
right,
issues, but this last meeting, it wasn't. It was just, I think what we were doing the last meeting was to keeping in mind that we wanted to meet on a regular basis. And that's what, why we really had that meeting, was to, you know, stay in that grain, that, you know, rather than wait 3 months and have another meeting, we want to have, as Councilor Hart had said, we should be meeting on a regular basis.
Right.
So, yeah,
so even, and you can just say, I mean, it can be the draft of the minutes.
Okay, so you're looking for something
fine.
In writing.
Right, just so we can have some.
Would that be the wishes of the rest of the council?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So noted.
Highway Public Safety, Councilor Jerry Hamill.
I believe the last time we met was probably June or July, and we meet as needed, so there's really nothing to report. We did get a letter from residents of that Fox Hollow development. Oh, I saw that in here. And, I mean,
I'm not surprised they're concerned about it because it was pretty bad. But apparently it passed the planning board and passed all the rules it needs to pass. So just when it was proposed, that was
debate.
The first problem that I noticed too.
I responded to the lady mm-hmm. and indicated that you know, it would be brought before the public safety committee. But I think that's the only issue we have right now, so I haven't had an opportunity to, since I wrote that, to talk with you about scheduling the meeting.
I'm not sure what can be done.
I don't
know. Other than a sign to address the concerns. It's not like you're going to redo the road there.
It's kind of like the street light at the intersection of the new housing project. That's the street light that we require under our ordinance. Mm.
I know how they feel because I got the L&M lights and the street light in my bedroom. But that's the way it is.
You'll never run into furniture.
It is.
NCDC Councilor Hart.
The only update is, well, Peter Hamlin mentioned it, which is good, that the NBA shared with the NCDC that they were going to do this revealing of their endorsement letter, I think is what it's been called in discussions with us, which outlines their vision and votes of actions for downtown and related stuff. So we discussed with them, well, since the NCDC is undertaking this process about the redevelopment of the mills, why not combine and have one kind of event that would highlight both in a setting so the information could be shared with both interested individuals and businesses. And so that's been set for February 16th, and I think we're going to try to do it in the basement here. You've hopefully been contacted about scheduling that.
Kathy would be the one. I'll check with her in the morning.
And there was a discussion and a request that it be broadcast. And if
the 16th, is that a Saturday or is it?
No, it's some night of the week.
Okay, it shouldn't
Tuesday,
be a problem.
I believe.
I think Thursday. I think we chose a Thursday to because there's not that many meeting Thursdays. And if there's a cost to have it broadcast, that is something that could be covered.
Okay.
Because that's a possibility.
Yeah. Okay.
So that was a good thing, and we've gotten some residents in town shared some information with us about prospective developers who are doing similar projects. So we've been gathering some new developer names. That's been helpful. And we've gotten more names of consultants that have been sent. I know Arlen Chafee has been doing some walkthroughs of the mills. He's been very busy as our new chair, showing the mills to prospective developers and or consultants. So I think we're going to get some good responses to the request for proposals. So that's exciting. That's all.
I have a question.
Sure.
Did you say March 16th? I'm sorry.
February.
February 16th. It's a Thursday at 7 o'clock. I don't know if you mentioned the time.
I was hoping it was going to be like the Stone Church and they'd have great appetizers and beer like in the past, but apparently we'll have to go up there afterwards. So.
And who's this meeting between?
It's a public event.
Oh.
So anybody is welcome to come. Hear about the Business Association's ideas and hear about the NCDC's process for the mill redevelopment. We won't have any announcements or anything like that. It's just be, you know, here's the process that we're undertaking, answer questions, et cetera.
Will it be on the website, TV website?
If we can be arranged to have staff available to broadcast it, it'll be rebroadcast on channel 13.
I mean, as an announcement.
I don't know.
Public service announcement.
It's not really a town event, so.
Well,
that's
impacting the town.
Well, you know, I think
it's up to. It'd be great, but I'm not sure if I can direct that. So
I think
I'll talk with staff in the morning.
I think the vice president of the Newmarket Business Association, Mrs. Russell, was going to try to contact Kathy, and she was actually looking for the e-person, and I actually directed her to you first, and then she can.
Oh, great.
She wasn't sure who the new computer person was or how to go about that, what the process was to get something on the television. So.
Generally, if she just contacts my office, either me or Kathy,
okay.
Kathy will get the ball rolling.
Thank you.
Thank you. Planning board update, Councilor Jarvis.
I don't know if anybody has any questions for me on the summary that I provided, basically just about the continuation of a public hearing for the Quacks property.
I do have a question.
Okay.
They keep saying in the announcements when the planning board agendas come out that there's 15 acres that's going to be deeded to the town. The town council has to vote on that, so it might be good that the planning board ask for town council input at some point about whether or not we want to own that land.
Right, and that has been stated by the chair a couple times that it still has to go to the town council.
And then the second, okay, that's good. I don't particularly see any issue why I would think it'd be a problem that we'd want to own it, but I don't want there to be suddenly a concern expressed that stops us from voting on it, and then the owners feel like we're, you know, messing it up on purpose, or that there's, you know, concern on the planning board. So, and then the other part is it keeps saying that there's discussions with town officials about the remaining land, and I'm wondering who the town officials are and what, when are we going to get an update on that?
You're talking about the same land?
No, it's different. It says the because it specifically says the driving range will no longer exist, and that there's discussions with towns the town about that land.
About the open space?
No, that's separate. There's, if you read the announcements, it seems like there's two areas that are being discussed.
Clay has talked to me. I can advise you in public, okay. Visits if you like them.
That'd be good. That'd be helpful. Thank you. Thank you, Jen.
Yep.
Okay, and the next item is school board, and that would be me, and my meeting's tomorrow night, but they have been, just an update, as far as the new school, they have announced publicly, you know, where the school's going to be, the estimated cost of the school, I believe they showed
34
sketches. What the tax impacts would be. There's been articles in the newspaper. And there'll be future meetings. And if you guys have any questions, I'd be happy to answer them, but my meeting's tomorrow night. My meetings run the meeting after our meetings. Okay. Next item is old business and other business, and I just have a few things. The Orton, Miss Orton's letter is going to be handed over to the Highway Safety Committee, Al, you said?
Yes.
Okay.
Well, it already has.
Okay, so they got to have a meeting. Okay.
We just got to get together with Jerry to schedule a meeting.
You guys all got a summary from Rick on the live-in program that you guys can look over. Probably we'll discuss that at our February workshop, I would think.
Isn't that too late to get the warrant?
No. You have time on the warrant.
Well, and we can discuss it Saturday.
Saturday, yeah.
But I want to say something about Saturday. We still have recreation and what?
Library.
And the library to do Saturday. Then we got to debate the budget. Then we have all those warrant articles to go through. I don't know if you guys want to do a shorter day on Saturday and have another meeting, or if you just want to go through. What I'm trying to do is separate the deliberation of the budget from the warrant articles. I'd like to do two separate. I just think it's too much.
What are you proposing?
Belabor and.
I would have a time constraint on Saturday. I'd have to be out of here by like 5:45.
Well, I was hoping by 1 o'clock.
Well, I don't know.
Oh, by 1. Oh, okay.
Be a problem.
I'll do it on Saturday then. I thought you were talking about.
No, I want to make two different meetings.
So you say next Wednesday we have a special meeting to talk about warrant articles.
Right. Tell me what you think. If you think it's crazy, then.
No, I think you're right.
I just think it's too much too heavy topics to debate, and I'm afraid that when we get to the warrant articles, people are just gonna be like, oh,
we're gonna
I'm
get
tired
friendship.
Of fighting. Or, you know what I mean?
Us fight? Come on.
Tired of cutting?
Whatever. Tired, period.
Contestant.
That's fine. Why don't we do this? Because we need to post it before Saturday. Post it for Wednesday. If we don't need it, we cancel it. If somehow we go through the budget really fast and to do all the warrant articles on Saturday,
I mean,
and we don't need the meeting on Wednesday, that'd be nice not to have another.
My personal opinion is the budget's fairly lean. I mean, I think there's some cuts that I don't think will be deliberated, really.
Unless
so hats off to the administrator and staff. They did a good job.
We should need a motion on this?
No, I'm just asking.
I would concur. Let's do like Saturday the budget, finish it, and then Wednesday the warrant article.
What date is that Wednesday?
25th.
I mean,
I'm sorry.
Yeah.
I think that makes sense. Or take a Saturday, another Saturday morning.
No
more Saturdays.
No more Saturdays.
Are you all set, Al?
All set.
Okay.
I just wanted to indicate that Spring Street property, just to follow up, the testing results have been completed. We have an ash content in the stockpile we have there, and it exceeds state limits, so we're going to use it on site. The other 14 samples that were taken of the lot are okay. We have exceeded the $8,000 allocated. John could not give an estimate of cost on this because it was such a broad scope, and so he took the tests, he took the samples, had them analyzed and all that. So we are at 9250 on the testing. So I want you to know that, and perhaps maybe since you only authorized 8, you should authorize another $1,250. Also, if you want a written report for our files on the findings and everything, that's another $1,500.
Was the last thing?
A written report.
Summary, as opposed from the hard data that he gave us?
Well, he hasn't really given you any hard data.
So what do we pay him $9,250 for?
Testing.
But I mean, do we get
laboratory
copies of the
results?
And
the laboratory results, yeah.
But you don't get an analysis and a summary and conclusions.
Right. The numbers don't get turned into English, is what you're saying.
Yes,
that's
right.
You just got the analysis.
It's worth it, I say.
Huh. What, the $1,500? I do too.
It's $1,500.
It's something on file.
Could we get copies of, or at least could I get copies of the lab reports and stuff?
Sure.
Mm.
Want to kill a tree? It's all right.
Is it that big?
Well, you know, that's okay. No.
Oh, can I come in and look at it? Maybe that's
sure.
It. Yeah, I'll come in and look at it.
Okay. So, do you need that in the form of a resolution now?
Well.
Or do you want a motion or?
I think I'll prepare a resolution for the February business meeting. I just want to make you aware of it. Then the coordinator has been hired. She accepted the position. She will commence her work January 30th. Her name is Julie Glover. She'll be here at the, I'll have her here for the business meeting to introduce her.
January 30th.
And I think we can have her up to speed within 30 days.
I think we should,
Can I just, my light was on about the other thing.
My light was
I know.
On.
Okay. Well, wait a minute. I wasn't even done with my stuff.
Oh.
So I thought Al was going to talk about what I was talking about.
I'm sorry.
That's okay. That's all right. So.
What were you talking
it
about?
It does go. Well, I still have 4 things under my list. So.
I'm sorry.
Nope. That's all right. I wasn't going to interrupt you once you were on. So after Al's done and I'm done, then it's Dana, Brian, and Jen. Oh, but you had a question on something.
I just had a question on something he said.
Okay.
Me too.
Are the light's been on for 4 minutes, so hasn't been talking for 4 minutes.
No, but I started early.
Can
he
I
got? He pushed the button. He was ready with his questions.
Before I answered him.
No. You go.
I just have a question. If we authorize you to allocate up to a certain amount, and we say not to exceed $8,000, how do you authorize going over that without us first talking about it?
Well, I have no, first of all, the testing was authorized. The samples were taken. I have no idea what the costs are going to be in those samples, and John Pasquale could not give us a solid estimate of any kind.
And I don't think we did a not to exceed vote on
that. We did a not to exceed $8,000. Mm-hmm. So you would think, I'm just looking at this as a process point. If we say not to exceed something, and then it comes back and say, guess what, it already exceeded that, then what's the point of us saying not to exceed?
Well, like I said, he took the samples he felt he needed. And the cost results comes back. He didn't give us an estimate up front. Couldn't.
So where did the $8,000 come from?
I think you pulled it out of your hat last time.
I did. I thought that's what I remember from previous discussions about, because remember we had the public saying, there's toxic waste underneath there, there's buried drums, you don't know what's there, do tests. And John was like, it's going to cost at least this much to do borings. And I remember, that's why that number came from. And that was like a year and a half ago, so it's my memory.
It wasn't a year and a half ago.
No,
it was
the first time.
Oh, the first time. Oh, the first time he said
that. Before we bought the property, we had a public hearing about buying it and
people address concerns. John was there.
And I mean, if we could just take this experience out of it, not to, because I don't want to minimize the importance of testing those materials, but if we say as a board, we authorize you to do something not to exceed a certain amount, then I just feel we need to know that the person that you're contracting with should be told, I've only been authorized up to $8,000. If it gets to a point where it's going to become more than that, you need to come back to us and say, just so you know, this is heading in this direction, which you've done before, so that we have a heads up on it. Well, otherwise, it seems pointless for us.
I don't think he had any idea at the point. That's at that point, is what I'm saying. Yeah. The scope of the testing. And
I can explain that.
Go ahead.
I had to authorize that, and the reason for that, and I did tell Al about it today, John thought we could live within the 8,000. When we took the hit on the ash, it required additional sampling to prove that we weren't hiding something.
Tell me when we took the hit on the ash. Explain what that means.
First, we sampled the big foamy pile.
Right.
The ash is everywhere. Ash is in your yard, my yard, every single, it's everywhere, from people burning wood,
right,
coal. It's a natural fact. The state sets a limit. If it goes over that limit, you can't move that material from the site. It has to stay on the site.
Either that or you put it in a secure landfill.
Because that we were over that limit to do additional testings, which John felt confident it was just in the topsoil because it's everywhere. It's everywhere. So we went down and took samples lower, deeper down where we figured there'd be no ash, and there was nothing. Didn't find anything. Then we took samples further up. Got up closer. So then we took a foot off the top. And every time we did this, we had to take additional tests and samples. So it drove the cost up. But you didn't, once we committed to the testing, you couldn't say, no, we're not going to do that, because it would look like you're trying to hide something. We had to close the loop in the testing to show that we tested at 8 feet, 6 feet, 4 feet, 2 feet, 1 foot.
So you could show where the contamination really lied.
We had to take additional testing, which, even if he said it was going to cost $15,000, because we initiated it from the beginning, I don't know if you're following, you had to do those additional tests to prove that there was nothing else there, because we took a test up here, then we took a test way down here. Why didn't you test the middle?
Right, and I appreciate that. That helps me understand why we had to do it this time. But I would say for future, if we make a not to exceed something, I'd like you to be able to come back to us if you know that it's headed in that direction.
Well, I didn't know, that's
okay.
A simple answer.
We found that out today, Jim.
Today?
That happened today.
Okay.
We found out today that the cost, John thought we could live within the budget, and then because we had to take the additional samples, we went over. But we had to take them. You couldn't say no, because it would look
like we were hiding something.
So we had to close it. Now we've closed it. Everything's up to snuff. And you really should do that final report just for
right,
our files.
We've
we don't
already
have
spent
to submit
them.
It. So if anything ever comes up down the road, we can pull this out and say, see, everything's good. But I did that and just let Al know after the fact. That was my doing.
But you couldn't stop that stream. If we did, we...
Right, and I'm not saying that we would have, like I said before, to take this project out of it. It's just a process thing. Why do we say not to exceed if we're going to exceed? It's so that we keep it for future
projects. Yeah, well, we didn't
projects.
Have a contract with John. He couldn't, say that, it's just too broad. He couldn't give
right.
a
quick word in on this.
Right. I understand John and Rick's point on the Spring Street property, as long as we just keep that point in mind
I
for
have
the future.
Are you, is that what she say, asking that you do in the future? Is that exactly what you're doing right now?
What's that?
Coming to us and let it, because you just found out today that it's going to exceed?
Yeah, as soon as I knew,
Oh, okay, so, great, keep it up. That's great.
Well, she wants to know before the fact, and sometimes...
Well, no, but that's, you're basically asking him to do what he's doing, in a sense, right? Like, he found out today as soon as he...
No, she's asking the question of why do we say not to exceed?
It's still my turn.
Yeah, but it's related to this.
Oh, go ahead.
But my only question is, Al, I understand and I know where you're coming from. However, in the future, when something like that does happen, it may be proper, because you can't notify us all. That's impossible. But to notify the chair that this is going to happen, because the chair is ultimately responsible. The head.
I think I found out about that about 3:30 this afternoon.
Right. Yeah. But I mean, she had heads on it prior to tonight's meeting. That's my whole point.
Well, the testing, I've talked to her about the testing, but not the cost. And I had no idea that it was going to sit over it until this afternoon.
That's all I had on that issue, but when you're done, I have some other questions.
Okay. Is that all you have, Al?
Yeah, we're going to have non-public to discuss the land.
Okay. The only the other thing that I had is Follett's Brook. There's a meeting Monday night, and on the agenda is discussion of the January 6, 2006 meeting with DES and recommendations to the town council. Discussion of recommendations to the town council for development of Follett's Brook for Rockwells, and discussion for recommendations to the planning boards in regards to the Quox subdivision as to its possible effects on the Follett's Brook watershed. I believe at the last meeting I shared with you guys how the DES meeting went, and it wasn't very promising. And I just want some direction when I go Monday night as to what you guys' feelings are. I mean, do you want to continue with the process knowing that DS sat there and said, we are not fond of approving permits for short-term water solutions, pretty much is what they said.
And they're going to treat this as a new source, which makes it very expensive.
Permitting will be very expensive. Jared, go ahead.
Well, I'm on that committee, and I'm just wondering, why are they saying it's a short-term water solution? Because we were never saying it was a short-term water solution.
Right.
In fact, there was quite a lot of enthusiasm when we first got the committee together and started in the direction of reviving that. And so, you know, I think given even some of the proposals that we've got before us for drawing water out of Lee, I mean, that's pretty far-fetched as far as I'm concerned, but we're going to proceed with that. I think we ought to go a few more steps on this Follett's Brook thing, and I don't think the costs are going to be great to maybe pursue a couple different directions, but maybe more just time involvement to pursue some other directions, or some other support, let's say. But that's what I'd like to see myself, because I mean, it's a water source that's proven itself real well in the past.
And just for clarification, I'm just the messenger. I'm just telling you what was said. I'm getting the distinct impression, and maybe you can call me stupid 6 months from now or deaf, but I clearly heard thanks but no thanks. And I'm pretty intuitive. That's what I heard. And I'm just saying that we can spend another $50,000. I wouldn't be in favor. And I'm not saying that there's not potential there. I'm just telling you what I heard. And I'm just being the messenger because that's my job. Councilor Morrison.
What do we have to pay for? Does the permit become costly when we're applying for it, or when we're approved all the way along?
In order to get approved, you have to apply.
The process.
And they are going to treat it as a brand new water source, which means you go through the whole gamut of the application process.
Is there any way to argue that it isn't in the same old river?
Yes, we have. You mean that it's not a new source?
A new source?
You mean, is there any way to argue it and win?
No.
Oh. That's not
happening. Oh, wow. Okay.
That was very emphatic.
Councilor Hart?
Can someone provide a written summary of that meeting? Because we had a real terse overview. It'd be helpful to get a written summary, either from you or Al. Mm-hmm.
Well, I think DES was going to provide a follow-up.
A letter?
Overall summation.
I mean, I was a little surprised that at the last meeting when we discussed this, that there were statements made by Mr. Fillion about the quantity of water he was expecting from the wells. That seemed to far exceed what we had previously discussed. I think a 2 gallon per minute well is not something that we can count on producing enough water to be worth sticking from, you know, we had one of those three wells that we drilled in the rock was 2 gallons a minute or something like that. And the well that's in Follett's Brook, that's the original well, that's basically in the brook. It's like 15 feet or 5 feet away from the edge. I think if we draw more than 57,000 gallons a day from it, we're gonna have to go underneath that new large groundwater withdrawal process, which is just as substantial. It's a pretty significant process. I'm not saying we wouldn't do it, but that's gonna require us to suck water out of it at the maximum capacity for 24 hours or 48 hours. And you're gonna see, I can't imagine you're not gonna see Follett's Brook drop, because I think it's a groundwater influenced well. Oh, surface water, groundwater, they're connected.
Yeah.
So I don't know. I would like to get the summary of that report or the letter from DES to hear what they say, and then hear what the committee has to say, and then have the full committee here for a discussion.
It's too bad the full committee couldn't have been at that meeting. It's difficult for...
Who was at the meeting? Lorianne, you?
Yeah, and
George,
Leo, and Dennis, Abbott. Who else? Help me.
Maybe we can file special legislation next year that specifically exempts us from those rules. It says that DES shall treat Follett's Brook as a existing water source for the town of Newmarket. It's a little late.
It's been done before. Though.
Yeah, I'm not surprised. I mean, it's too late to submit it for this year. But if we find that our other approaches that we're exploring don't work, maybe that's the alternative.
They had there's a whole series of things. They're going to also look at the in-stream flow rates, unless we agreed to move. Well, they're going to believe me.
They're trying to.
But not before we.
This.
Not before we try.
Well. That we're going to have to do a study. Okay.
I wish I had a tape recording
yeah.
of the meeting.
And that was very clear. And then they suggested that it was way out of the in-stream study. And I don't know if it's cheaper to do the in-stream study or to do what they said, and that is move the filter bed. Leo doesn't agree with moving the filter bed. But if you move the filter bed down closer to the dry well that's down there, then the in-stream flow rules, as I understood it, went away. And now I don't know if that's a cheaper. Yep. Did.
Any sense to me.
Didn't that?
Yeah.
I don't disagree with what you're saying. I just don't understand it.
Well, like I said, I guess I'm kind of glad that I wasn't the only one there. Lorianne has to deliver that, too. It was a nice meeting, but...
It was very discouraging. That's how I felt.
Well, we're going to spend a lot of money. That was the bottom line. And probably not get it approved.
And they could play these games on any water source that this town... desires to improve, I guess.
And they can do it whenever they feel like it. But the message I got was that it's not a long-term solution, it's short-term, and we're not into approving short-term solutions.
They want Newmarket to look at the big picture.
Right.
But just basically...
They want something. They want you to go and apply for something that's going to provide substantial amounts of water. Long and into the future.
And that's what this study, we just hired this engineering company to go look for water.
And they actually thought the recharge idea was pretty good. They like that idea. That's it, and then I think Dana and then Brian. Under old business, other business.
This is under old business. I haven't seen a report from a request of January 4th business meeting regarding a cost analysis of the special town meeting.
I have it.
You have it? Okay.
Right here.
Thanks.
The other thing is... still waiting for the notice of the Riverwalk organizational meeting. I haven't
talked to staff after the last council meeting, and
Clay Mitchell's been heading that up, suggested it'd probably be good to wait till the project coordinator come on, so we're gonna charge the project coordinator with calling that meeting. The organization meeting. Because the project coordinator is gonna be taking over, overseeing that. Clay has been overseeing.
Okay, but we're not gonna be responsible to the project coordinator. The project coordinator is gonna work in unison with this committee.
Well, yes, but I mean, you know, yes.
Okay.
But the project coordinator will be moving things along.
So the committee won't meet till the project coordinator is
okay.
On staff and hired.
And this one that I hate to bring up, but unfortunately I've exhausted all my avenues and I now have to come public with it. And I've talked to Councilor Caprioli about this. And this goes way back to probably just before Mike Gill passed away. That I, to this day, cannot get access to my email account on the town website so I can answer the questions of my constituents that are out there. I have gone to you a couple of times, to Doug a couple of times, to Melody a couple of times, and to, I know you've talked to someone about it, but I don't think you've got a clear answer either on it. So I need, and I'd like to have it before the close of business on Friday, how to access my email account on my home, on my computer.
I will talk to staff tomorrow morning at staff meeting.
Okay, thank you. And I think that's all I had, broadband. Oh, and we will be televised live on Saturday morning, but not recorded, is that correct? And I guess
I don't know, I'll have to coordinate tomorrow morning with staff.
Okay, I would like to see, well, I don't know, at this point it doesn't really matter to record it because we haven't done any of the other ones, have we?
We were televising it, but we couldn't record it.
Right.
And Wednesday night, school board had it.
Right, exactly. So, I mean, I would like to see it to be recorded. I mean, it can't be that difficult for someone to, I mean, the other night we had the ZBA meeting and some guy came up and said, you know, yeah, I'll go downstairs and I'll record it. So, I mean, I don't know who the guy was, but I just don't understand why it's so difficult to record it other than just do a live broadcast.
We were doing it.
Can you look into that?
I will talk to staff.
Okay. That's based on what I'm asking you, can you please look into that for us? And that's really the questions I have. Thank you.
Thank you.
And thank you for providing.
Do you have a question regarding this?
I just a comment on something that Dennis just said. Mm-hmm. Is it a good idea that people that we don't even know their names are going down and playing with our telecommunications stuff?
I was wondering that myself.
No, I think he works here. He works.
Well, that's just, I'm not personally you, but I mean, you should know if he works here before he goes down. I mean, because that's some pretty expensive stuff. Should we?
I don't think we've had anyone down there that hasn't been authorized.
No. But I mean, do we know who was down there on the ZBA meeting?
No, I don't know. That would be something that Doug would have coordinated.
Oh, okay. So,
I'm sorry if I implied it. I just personally didn't know the guy's name, and I know he's from the town.
Oh,
the town
okay.
Hiding.
Oh, I
it
thought
sounded like someone
just
got up in the audience.
No.
Oh, here, let me go.
No.
I can push some buttons.
No, the guy came in and he said, "Do you want me to record?" And he was going downstairs to record it. I'm sorry. I didn't want to.
Whoa.
No.
That's good.
Okay.
I'll tell you, that stuff breaks
quick. Did you have
something
regarding recording?
Didn't I have a...
You do, but if it's about this question, is it about this?
Not about. Nope.
Okay. Councilor Hart.
A few weeks or a few months ago, I had gotten a call from Brian and Heather Lane, and I had brought it up about tax credits for energy, solar panels and things, and we were going to look into that and have it on the workshop. So
yes,
we can put that in the February workshop.
We did have some information that we compiled, that Andy compiled, and we will have it. It would take effect this April, so the stuff will come back before you. And
yeah,
it
does think.
You a package.
We got that. I think he mentioned, I saw it, Rand told me, he said he was working on it, that was a few months ago. But I think we should discuss it at a workshop, so then you know if we want to have you prepare the paperwork to put it into impact. And then the second part is, I think we, just to reaffirm that the February workshop, we were going to invite Mike Provost.
Right.
And to talk about this downtown person, construction, how to get through 19 months of construction and survive as a business and see. And so should I ask Mike to come or
I can give him a call.
Okay.
February workshop, okay.
Is it from the MCDC?
Well, he's on the MCDC, but he's a Main Street professional.
That's right.
Is that it, Brian?
That is, thank you.
Councilor Garvis.
Al, have we heard anything about the urban service boundary?
Yes. We have inundated the Office of Legal Services, and our bills are correctly reflecting that. He's got a backlog. He's getting through things on a priority basis as fast as he can.
Whose priority basis?
Ours.
Ours.
So you've prioritized what?